Seattle Mariners are Major League Baseball's arm and hammer team. Through his dominance of hitters, the intimidating Randy Johnson is the arm, while the hammer is Ken Griffey Jr., whose home run assault has become legendary. The Mariners try to clinch the American League West pennant next.
Here in Seattle, but a championship banner perhaps is ready to rise inside the Kingdome. A sellout crowd of over 55,000 on hand for what could be a historic night, as tonight the Seattle Mariners meet the Anaheim Angels. A win by the Mariners wraps up their second AL Western Division title in 3 years. The simple story, the Mariners' magic number is one. If they win tonight, they win the West and they head to the 1997 Major League Baseball postseason. Hello again, everybody. I'm Chip Carey along with Steve Psycho Lyons. Welcome back to the Kingdome in Seattle, where a big crowd is ready to watch the Mariners rock and roll tonight. And as Yogi Berra would say, my friend, it's deja vu time all over again for the Angels and the Mariners.
Well, the Mariners in 1995 sent their ace to the hill, Randy Johnson, to clinch it for them. They're going to do the same thing again tonight. Here's 1995, the final out against Tim Salmon. That sent them into the playoffs in perhaps one of the best divisional series I've ever seen against the Yankees. And the Angels are getting used to being on the other side of the coin. Last year in 96, they were the team that was on the field when the Rangers won the division. There's Randy Johnson warming up for tonight's start.
So the Angels battered and bruised, so is Randy Johnson, but he seeks his 19th win of the season for the Mariners. That, of course, the big picture. The other big story, of course, the home run chase by Ken Griffey Jr. He hit two of them yesterday in Oakland. He's got 55 home runs on the year, and interestingly enough, tonight's pitcher for the Angels, Alan Watson, has given up more runs than any pitcher in the American League. He surrendered 35 on the year. It's the Mariners and the Angels from the Kingdome next. Tonight's presentation of Major League Baseball on FX is brought to you by MCI. Is this a great time or what? Boy, they are rocking at the Kingdome in Seattle. A crowd of over 55,000 plus on its feet. The Mariners may go over 3 million in home attendance tonight. And what a night it could be. If Seattle wins tonight, they will clinch their second American League Western Division title. But the Anaheim Angels provide the opposition, and they will not quit. Here's their lineup, presented by their manager, Terry Collins. Tony Phillips leads it off at second base. Jim Edmonds in center, bats second. Tim Salmon, having a career year as the DH, and hits third. Dave Hollins, because of injury to Darren Erstad, plays first and is the cleanup man. Ricky Henderson in left. Garrett Anderson in right is the number six hitter. He's been on a tear of late. 10-game hitting streak for Anaheim. Luis Alcea at third, former Mariner Chad Kruder behind the plate, and a slick fielding shortstop Gary DeSarcina will bat ninth. On the mound is Cy Young Award winner Randy Johnson, seeking his 19th win of the season. Saw him pitch last time out against the Rangers, Steve. He didn't have his great stuff, had enough to get by, but this man, when he's on, is one of the premier hitters in the game.
And he's certainly good enough to get by when he's not on. I mean, this is the time where you talk about what he's got, the kind of pitches that he has, but forget about that. We know what he's got. The guy works on intimidation and arm angles. He's got the great stuff. He's the best guy to have on the mound in a crucial situation like tonight.
He was on a pitch count last time out and in his first two starts since coming back from the tendonitis problem in his hand. Lou Piniella told us before the game he will send Randy out there and let him go as long as he needs to go to get the job done. Seattle's defense is a good one. Kelly, Griffey, and Buehner in the outfield. Sheets, Rodriguez, Cora, and Blowers along the infield. Dan Wilson behind the plate. Russell Davis hurt with a torn ligament in his ankle. Lou Piniella telling us before the game as well, he's fielding ground balls, he's hitting, he's running, but he's having all kinds of trouble making cuts. So they're not sure whether or not Davis will be able to play come postseason time. So we're set to go. Randy Johnson facing the Angels with the division title on the line, and we're underway. Strike one to Phillips. Tony at 277 on the year, 8 homers, 57 runs batted in.
You can see by the numbers, 260 Phillips against Johnson. It's like hitting 320 against anybody else.
Johnson missing inside for ball one. Randy at 18-4. A 2.26 earned run average. He leads the American League in strikeouts with 277 of those. And he's got Phillips set up 1-2.
Now Tony Phillips already chirping at the plate. Didn't like the first called strike. Didn't like that one. That pitch was right down the middle. I don't know if he has an argument about that, but we all know the reputation of Phillips. If he gets going, it won't take long to get him out of the game by ejection.
Swung on, line drive into shallow right. Buehner coming on, and he makes the diving catch. Buehner with that great arm in right, an underrated fielder as well.
Well, we talked about his defense in the open right there. You see him dive headlong for the ball. This is the way you're supposed to dive and catch a baseball. I hate the way the guys are sliding now to catch the ball on plays that you should be diving for, just like Buehner did right there.
So base is empty, one out for Jimmy Edmonds, a 287 hitter, 24 home runs, 78 RBIs, and he takes a strike. McKean behind the plate with the overhand right.
Look at the difference in numbers, the home runs that Edmonds hits off of right-handed pitchers. That number tails way off against the lefties. That's not unusual.
A fastball, 94 miles an hour, misses outside, 1-1. Edmonds has had a phenomenal season. And with the exception of Ken Griffey Jr., maybe the most exciting center fielder in the game.
Well, this year, because he's been so banged up, he's been about a step and a half slower than he normally is, and that's forced him to dive for a lot more balls than he normally would.
Fastball, pop foul back our way. Don't worry, Psycho, I'll make the play. But heads toward us, 1-2 to Jim Edmonds.
Well, just like last time, I bailed out of the way. You made the grab. You want to see the intimidation that Randy Johnson has. Here's one of the best hitters in the game. Look at that. His rear end's almost in his own dugout when he swings at that ball. He didn't even want to be in the box.
Slider swung on, and he fisted that down the left field line. And out of play. Edmonds stays alive. 1-2. October 2nd, 1995. Maybe the biggest date in Mariner history. They won their first Western Division title. Randy Johnson outdueled Mark Langston, the former Mariner. Fastball just missed high. It's 2-2.
You take a guy like Edmonds, 287 on the year with 24 homers and 78 RBIs, and you can see how defensive he is at the plate right now against Johnson.
Line hard left center field. Nobody's going to get that ball. It's off the top of the wall. Gachet's back. It's a home run for Edmonds. A line drive opposite field homer, and Anaheim takes the 1-0 lead. Only his fifth home run of the year against the Southpaw, and he hit a rope.
This is just a mistake by Randy Johnson. Remember, he didn't get the call on the pitch before. That ball is fastball up and out over the plate. That's where Edmonds likes it. You can see right there, he's still bailing a little bit with that front hip, but he's got the kind of strength that can drive the ball the other way, even when he doesn't put a good swing on the ball.
And what a lift for the Anaheim Ball Club. You saw every member of that team out on the on-deck circle to greet Edmonds when he crossed home plate. They've got the 1-0 lead against the Mariners' intimidator, Randy Johnson. Now Tim Salmon on an 0-1 pitch pops it a mile high into shallow center. And Junior puts it away, and there's out number two.
Flying into Seattle today, we flew across all the mountain ranges, the sisters still with snow on them. That ball right there, you almost had to wipe the snow off of that ball when it came down.
So two outs, a run in. Edmonds has touched Johnson for just the ninth home run by a left-hander in Randy Johnson's major league pitching career. That's amazing. Dave Hollins, a former Mariner, lines it hard into the seats. And the count, nothing and one. Hollins playing first base for Darren Erstad, who's got a dislocated shoulder. He's not the only man on medical leave for Anaheim right now. They are really banged up. You take away Mark Langston, Chuck Finley, Mark Gubason, Todd Green, Craig Graybeck, Darren Erstad. Don't forget Jim Abbott, who started the season with Anaheim, at least in spring training. This is a ball club that's a shell of its true self right now. Holland swung late, 1-2.
Guys like Chris Turner and Troy Percival, who also spent time on the DL. Eddie Murray before he was out of here. Mike James, Rich DeLucia, Kyle Merrill, Finley, all these guys.
Lined hard to short. A-Rod gobbles it up, drifts to his left, throws out Hollins, and that retires the side. But Jim Edmonds, line five homer to left, makes it 1-0 Anaheim with Junior and the Mariners coming up. 1-0 Anaheim has the lead after a half inning here in Seattle. Let's take a look at the Mariners lineup presented by their manager, Lou Piniella. Seattle wins tonight. They win the West. Joey Cora leads it off. Roberto Kelly in left hits second. Ken Griffey Jr., 55 home runs, 145 runs batted in, hits third. Edgar Martinez, the DH. Alex Rodriguez at shortstop. Jay Buhner approaching a milestone as well, hits sixth. In right field, Dan Wilson, Mike Flowers, and Andy Sheets rounds out the Seattle lineup. Tonight's pitching opponent, left-hander Alan Watson, who has been absolutely crushed by the home run ball in 1997.
Now, giving up 35 of them this year, here's a guy who will sail along for about four or five innings, and then the next thing you know, he'll just absolutely lose it. That's been his problem all year long. Good pickup for this ball club overall. It gets a lot of run support for, as a ball club. An ERA of over five. I mean, he could have had more wins than he has right now.
The Anaheim defense, Ricky Henderson in left, Jim Edmonds, and Mr. Highlight Reel for Anaheim all year long, Anderson in right. Alisea playing third, Hollins at first. Again, we told you about the Darren Erstad situation. Phillips and DeSarcina up the middle, and Chad Kruder behind the plate. Joey Cora leads it off and takes a heater high and away. You see the breathe right strip across Cora's face. Interesting little story about Joey as he takes low. Cora, when he plays in the field, was always known for wearing the pins of Puerto Rico in his...
And a rooster, which was his nickname before they started calling him the Little Slim here.
Well, baseball said you can't wear any pins or any other stuff on your cap. You're out of uniform. So Cora now wearing that strip across his nose as a protest. And he said when the Mariners make the playoffs, he's going to wear the Puerto Rican flag on the strip. During the Mariners postseason run as a sign of protest.
Well, it seems to me that they're very selective as to what they will and will not let you do. We've seen numerous numbers written on caps this year. You'd think half the league died with all the different tributes to different guys' numbers on the hats this year.
Cora lines it in the left. So the Rooster says cock-a-doodle-doo to you, Alan Watson, a leadoff single here in the Seattle first.
Here's what we talked about with Alan Watson, too. If he throws pitches right there, we're going to see some balls land in the seats tonight. Watson has to hit his spots. He doesn't throw a fastball as hard as 90 miles an hour. His best pitch is his changeup. He's got to be able to establish the fastball on either side of the plate, not right down the middle.
So Cora, a pesky base runner on as well. Roberto Kelly, the hitter. Boy, what an acquisition this guy has been for the Mariner ball club. There was talk about Seattle maybe getting Ricky Henderson. Well, they went out and got Kelly, and he has paid big dividends. He's hit six homers, knocked in 20 in 27 games for Seattle since coming from the Twins. And he takes a strike, nothing and one. Kelly, the 50th different left fielder to play next to that man, Ken Griffey Jr.
And he's just waiting to take his hacks. Roberto Kelly is a guy who I think can really flourish within an outstanding offensive lineup. Played some best baseball when he was with the Yankees, and then he found himself in Minnesota where he didn't have anybody really. He's the kind of guy you need to forget about in the lineup. Then he can hurt you.
Little pop fly into shallow right center field. The Angels surrounded. Edmonds in center, quarterbacks on the play. And Kelly is retired. One out, one on. Here's Junior.
Number
homers say it all. 55 homers, 145 batted in.
We came onto the field today and Junior looked at me and says, what are we going to talk about tonight? And I said, well, certainly not your home runs. I'm tired of talking about those. He said, well, good. Let's talk about my golf game then.
Line drive over the glove of DeSarcina at short. The crouching MVP is Griffey took the hack. And I think they're going to be right on target. If he's not, there's no justice.
And justice might be one of the guys getting some votes. This is classic Ken Griffey Jr. Look at that pitch. Low and away. Nobody else hits that pitch per base hit, I'm telling you. That's a nasty pitcher's pitch. The guy gets great extension through the zone. His head's down on the ball. You get the feeling the crowd was a little bit upset that he only hit a single.
He's been in one of those grooves where every time he steps up, it is a magical moment. But now the Mariners threatening to get the run back here in the first. Two on, one out. Edgar Martinez, the hitter. He's second in the circuit with a 3.32 average, and he takes a strike. It's nothing and one. No chop liver this guy either. 28 homers, 108 batted in. Second in average, ninth in ribbies. Every single Mariner tonight in the lineup, with the exception of Mike Flowers, has hit 10 or more home runs. And Flowers playing first base for Paul Sorrento, who's a left-hand hitter. Look out, folks. Edgar lost the handle.
He lost the rest of it, too. That's so dangerous because when the bat is still twirling on its way in, as a fan, you don't know which end of the bat to try to catch. This guy, with his sweater tied around his neck and everything, he's styling and ready and waiting.
He was bailing on the
play.
Yeah,
that's exactly what he was looking too good to try to catch it.
Well, now the security detail comes over and grabs the bat. Let's see if they...
That's weak because you know she's deep it.
See if they give him the fan a replacement piece of lumber here.
She say, no, it's official business. I have to take this bat and get it back down to the ball player. Then she's going to go downstairs and put it in her trunk.
Two on, one out. Edgar Martinez in a two-strike hole. He's one for three lifetime against the Anaheim left-hander, Alan Watson. Away. You're not going to get this guy to go fishing too often.
This guy has one of the best eyes in the game and one of the best up-the-middle swings. The guy waits on the ball as long as anybody in baseball, doesn't have to pull the ball. He will guess at times, think pull, but for the most part, he's going to try to whiz it right back past Alan Watson's left ear.
Watson fakes towards second. Cora virtually atop the bag. 1-0 just underway at the Kingdome in Seattle. Mariners with an 88-69 record can wrap up the title with a victory tonight. They've got their ace Randy Johnson on the mound, but Jim Edmonds has made it 1-0 with a solo home run. Fastball ripped back to the screen.
As we alluded to in the open with Randy Johnson back on the hill against the same Angel ball club 2 years ago, the one-game playoff that the Mariners won. He went on to play the Yankees in the five-game divisional series. That series, along with the one-game playoff, saved baseball in this city.
Well, I think that was part of it. I think Lou Piniella coming here as well was a huge factor, even before the Mariners won that playoff series. Pinella gave this ball club an identity it never really had. Pinella was a man who had won a championship before with Cincinnati. He was, as a manager, that is, won several titles as a member of the Yankees. And I think that move all by itself signaled a commitment to excellence by ownership here. That just missed the strike zone, 2-2. And for many years, this was, in fairness, this was the Siberia of baseball. The Mariners were perennially a disaster on the field. But finally, with some great selects by their scouting department, the ownership group finally solidified, and Lou Piniella coming in really made the situation turn around here. The 2-2. Ah, foul and out of play again, but you're right, your point is well taken. In creating a fever and expectation of excellence and expectation of winning baseball year in and year out, that series against the Yankees was extremely important.
There's a lot of talk about this team not coming back here, moving to a different location. Now they're building a new stadium.
Yeah, they were all but gone to Tampa Bay 5 years ago. How times do change. The 2-2, Ted Edgar is inside. He was behind 0-2. Now Watson's running full, 3-2.
Classic Edgar Martinez loses his gamer into the seats. Picks up another bat, works the count to full. Fouled off a couple nasty pitches. Working the count into a situation that he can get a pitch that he can handle.
Cora at second, a junior at first. Edgar Martinez digging in. Runners go, pitch fouled back to the screen. So the count stays 3-2. Watson throwing a lot of pitches here in the opening inning.
Such a classic situation for Lou Piniella to be in, with Cora on second with great speed, Griffey on first with great speed, a full count to Edgar, doesn't strike out that much, put the guys in motion.
Big leads by both Cora and Griffey. Again, Watson spins, does not throw. Now wants Kruder to go through the signs again. Boy, this place ready to erupt.
That was the one thing that the Edmonds home run did, was took the crowd out of the ball game in the first inning. You need something to get excited about.
Little number toward first. Easy play there for Hollins. He makes it. Runners advance 90 feet. There are, however, two outs for Alex Rodriguez. Rodriguez became the third Mariner with 20 homers and 20 stolen bases. Earlier this year, he's hitting .298 on the season. He joins Rupert Jones and Phil Bradley as the only three Mariners to join the 2020 club. Lifetime 2-4-4 against Watson. Second and third, two outs. And he takes low and away. One ball, no strikes.
You look at the numbers on Rodriguez, hitting right around 300 with the 23 home runs, driven in over 80. I think that's a pretty darn good year, but his numbers last year were so tremendous, it almost lends itself to be able to say he's having a little bit of an off season. That would be wrong.
Way high. It's 2-0.
Rodriguez, I think, more than anything this year, is most dissatisfied with his play in the field. The 24 errors this season is not something that he's that happy about. Something that he says he'll work on and make sure that doesn't happen again, especially when you play 81 of your games at home on the turf. Not happy with his defensive play this year.
The runners lead now. The 2-0 is swung on, line drive, base hit center field. Cora scores. Here comes Griffey around third. He stumbled as he hit the bag and now has to scamper back to third.
I think he missed third base, Chip. I think that's why he stopped and turned around and came back. He looks like his leg is hurting a little bit.
He hit the bag very awkwardly, stumbled around third base, was about 15, 20 feet down the line, then ran back just to be safe. In any event, we are tied at one.
That's just a great piece of hitting, letting the breaking ball break, smashing it right back up the middle.
So we're tied at one, third hit of the inning for the Mariners. Now first and third with two down. That's a shame for Seattle. Griffey would have scored with ease.
Yeah, I think he missed third, and in doing that, I think he took a funny step there and stumbled around it and then stopped because he realized that if he tried to score and they appealed, he would have been out.
So he stays at third. He's the potential go-ahead run for Seattle, and he is limping noticeably down the third base line. He's asking the umpire, Jimmy Joyce, did I touch the bag? And I'm not sure that he did. Jay Buhner stands in, a chance for the Mariners to jump in front. And he takes high. Jay on the year, 243 average, 39 home runs, 106 runs batted in.
Hey, look at those numbers right there, the 27, 39 on the road. A lot of people talk about the Kingdome here being a great home run hitter's ballpark. Buhner hit most of his on the road this year.
Well, he's trying to hit 40 home runs for the third consecutive year for the Mariners. The 1-1. He took it low. Two balls and a strike. This is the guy the Yankees let get away. Lou Piniello was the manager of the Yankees when the ill-fated Jay Buhner for Ken Phelps trade. Lou said last year, asked him, how do you like that deal? He says, I like it a lot better now.
Yeah, now that I have him.
There's a surprise. A 2-1. Swung on, belted. Deep toward left. That ball is long gone.
Just get the feeling that he's so locked in. That ball is hammered. That is in the upper deck here. That doesn't happen very often. That's about four rows back. And you don't see that very often. Jay Buhner doesn't stand and watch very many of his home runs. 40th home run for the third year in a row for Jay Buhner. The 36th allowed by Alan Watson.
258 by the Mariner team, a new record, and a curtain call for Buhner as Seattle has put four on the board with Randy Johnson on the mound. Dan Wilson, the hitter, and talk about a tough job. How do you follow that?
Well, I'll tell you, Chip, we've done six or seven Mariner games this year. We've seen Buhner struggle at times. At bat, I just never seen him feel this year anyway any more comfortable at the plate than he looked right there.
Wilson lines hard to Alisea at third, and that retires the side. Four runs, four hits. Jay Buhner's 40th home run makes it 4-1 Seattle. Buhner greeted by the fans and watch the hat.
You get the feeling that one's a little bit more special to him than some of the others. Very rarely stands and admires any of the balls that he hits. He's a no-nonsense guy, hits the ball and runs.
So Randy Johnson's got the lead. Ricky Henderson stands in. 258 home runs now hit by the Mariners. That surpasses the Orioles' mark by one set last year. Ricky takes strike two. Tried to jackknife out of the way. Didn't like the call.
Well, it's funny, the friendly competition that they've got going on between Buhner and Griffey. They've been betting each other dinners on who would hit the ball out of the park. Buhner went out of the yard twice on Saturday. Griffey returned the favor, did it twice on Sunday. And now Buhner's got one today.
Way outside, one ball, two strikes. Ricky Henderson leading it off for Anaheim. Well, they thought he was going to be the answer for them with all the off-field troubles Tony Phillips was having. So far, it hasn't been the answer. He's six for his last 57. Make it 58. He didn't like that call either, and Johnson has his first strikeout of the game.
Now, Ricky doesn't generally like the strikes that are called against him when he doesn't swing. Sorry, Ricky, but that ball's right down the middle.
So give Randy Johnson his 278th punch out of the year. Base is empty, one out for Garrett Anderson, who's been the hottest halo. He's got a 10-game hit streak. Coming into tonight's play, a 305 average, and this kid's got superstar written all over him, I think. He's a great-looking ball player.
I think his power numbers are just going to continue to improve. You look at the RBIs, has a chance to drive in 100. He'd have to get a few in the next few ball games, but driving in 100 runs without hitting 10 home runs, tough to do. I think Tommy Herr was the last guy to do it a few years back.
And that was with the running Redbirds with Vince Coleman and Willie McGee at the top of the order in St. Louis. The 0-2. Slider got it. And if he gets that pitch over, that's the key. That's the pitch that's a key for Randy Johnson. You know he's got the 100-mile-an-hour fastball. If he can throw that breaking ball for strikes, it's going to be a long night.
Now you see where this breaking ball is. That one, I bet if you ask Randy Johnson, he'd be a little dissatisfied with the location because it's up a little bit. But if he starts running that to the outside part of the plate and getting that call consistently, remember the pitch that he threw to Edmonds was a pitch that was not called a strike. It was the pitch that he wants. Next pitch ended up out of the park.
Luis Alcea takes low. One ball, no strikes. Alcea, 256 hitter, a second baseman by trade, playing third base because of all the injury problems Terry Collins has to deal with. There's a nasty breaking ball. And that thing really snapped off, and Alcea barking a bit.
You're going to have a lot of guys barking because of the kind of stuff that Randy has and his reputation. He's going to get the borderline calls.
Bouncing ball up the middle. A-Rod can't get it. It's two-out single by Alcea. Good piece of hitting by the Angels third baseman now. Well, this is a scrappy team. And, boy, you talk about a club that's taken on the personality of its manager. Terry Collins has wrung an awful lot out of this ball club. And, again, not to belabor the point, but when you're fighting into September, trying to stay alive, and three of your top four starters are on the disabled list, it's an amazing job that they're still alive with a week to play in the season. That's a tremendous job of managing.
Yeah, I don't care who you are. If you think you got the best team in the game and your top players get hurt, you're probably not going to win. In any sport, it doesn't matter. You field your best nine guys in a game of baseball, and you feel like there are the horses to take you to the playoffs, and then three or four of those guys get hurt, you can forget about it.
Chad Kruder takes high, a guy that's kind of a modern medical miracle as far as baseball is concerned. His shoulder was horribly shattered in a home plate collision. Doctors told him, look, you're probably never going to play again. Well, he's proven the doctors wrong. He's come back and has had a solid season for the Anaheim Ball Club. And he takes strike two. 96 miles an hour, and Johnson, he's got it in the mid-90s now. He's a guy that gets stronger as the game gets longer. He might still have that kind of heat later on.
I told Kruder he's lucky to be married after bumping his head in Detroit a few weeks ago, knocking his two front teeth out.
Close play at first. Alcea just got back. Yeah, he's had a rough year. He's been hit in the head with a bat on a backswing. He's had both of his teeth knocked out. He smashed into the ceiling of the dugout roof in Tiger Stadium.
He says, I'm not even going to bother fixing those teeth until the end of the season.
Yeah, his family crest is a black cat.
Yeah. You know, he had the caps re-put on the front two teeth, and then he got hit with the backswing in the back of his head, and it knocked him out again. Oh. He said, forget about it. I'll wait till the end of the year.
The 1-2 pitch as Alcea dances around. Johnson keeps it close. Over at first base.
I'm a little surprised that Randy's even thrown over there a couple times. Alcea has good speed. He will run. Good time to run. But Johnson, when he's on and feeling confident, says, go ahead. Number one, I got Danny Wilson behind the plate. And number two, this guy strikes out. You're not going anywhere anyway.
He strikes out the side. Randy Johnson with three punch outs leads it 4-1. It's 4-1. Mariners leading the Angels after 1.5. Friends, every Saturday in October, FX brings you college football. Starting October 4th, tune into FX for the best in Big 12 and Pac-10 action. Catch the excitement of college football every Saturday in October on FX, Fox Gone Cable. Chip and Psycho from the Kingdome in Seattle. Jay Buhner's long three-run homer, the big blow in the game tonight. And the Mariners enjoy the 4-1 lead. Mike Blowers leading things off. He had a home run cut. And he came up empty. Mike, a longtime Mariner. He lives down I-5, about 30 minutes south of Seattle in Tacoma. Played last year briefly for the Dodgers before tearing up his knee rounding third base. Now back with the Mariners playing as a DH, first baseman, part-time outfielder, but until his knee gets back to 100%, it's unlikely he'll be a third baseman again, especially playing on the turf every day.
Well, they may have to count on Blowers at the plate somewhere. Russ Davis still hurt. As you mentioned before, we talked to Lou Piniella about that. They're not really counting on Davis being back, at least for the first two rounds of the playoffs. He's in his ankle just isn't responding the way they'd hoped it would. They have Andy Sheets and Brent Gates over there at third base. Flowers filling in at first today with Sorrento on the bench with the lefty. Flowers is probably going to get some playing time. He's hitting over 300, but the power numbers this year have not been there for him. And I think that he has a chance of being a key member of this club. I mean, he may get some key at-bats into the playoffs. You look for a weak link in the lineup, I would think the opposition would point to him. He would have the chance to hurt some guys.
Fastball tied him up inside. Now the count full.
Get into situations where the other team might walk a man to get to Blowers, knowing that he is, at least for this season, one of the unproven players in the lineup.
The payoff. Change ripped into center field. On comes Edmonds, makes a basket catch knee high in center. One out. He covered a lot of ground and made a fine running catch to retire Blowers.
Now the key to Edmonds is getting a great jump out there. A lot of times guys play in the outfield, they just don't prepare themselves to make a play the same way an infielder would. And that's just a big mistake. Jimmy Edmonds says to himself, I think the guy's going to hit the ball to me on every pitch. And that way he's always ready to make a play.
Andy Sheets, starting at third base, takes strike one. Sheets doing all right offensively, hitting 282. The glove is a question mark, however, for this youngster. He's had some tough times at the hot corner. Sheets on the year.
Seven errors.
In 27 games. That foul tipped into Kruder's glove. One ball, two strikes.
Now see, that's the opposite end of the spectrum there with Sheets. If he's going to get some playing time, he is going to hit down in the order, eighth, ninth. His job is to go out and make sure he catches the ball. Don't make the team look bad in the field. It's sort of like being a guy who's a ninth inning defensive replacement. The only way you can mess up is if you miss the ball. Job is to go out and catch the ball. What he gives this team offensively is going to be a bonus considering the rest of the guys in the lineup.
Hit hard toward first. Hollins knocks it down. He'll win the race to the bag. And Sheets is retiring for out number two.
Well, the one good thing about being over there at first base is you can take a top hop like that, get your chest in front of it, knock it down, still beat the guy to the bag. And Sheets can pick him up and put him down pretty quick. I always used to say third base was the place where you could knock it down and throw him out. I don't believe that. You knock it down at third base, stand up, go over and pick it up, the guy's safe by the time you try to throw him out. First base, you can get away with it.
Yeah, it depends what you're picking up, the ball or your teeth.
and occasionally both.
That's, yeah, exactly. Here's Cora, one for one, scored the first Mariner run. That ahead of an Alex Rodriguez RBI single. Boy, this guy has had quite a year, Joey Cora, an all-star for the Seattle team. And boy, it was really refreshing to see how much he enjoyed being a part of the all-star experience. The guys there that had been there two, three, four, five times. For Cora, it was, as he said, just an awesome experience to be in the same room with the greats of the game.
He looks good with the protest band-aid. I like it.
A 2-1. It's 3-1.
Yeah, I began to say that it seems like baseball is very selective as to who they point out to, whether or not they can wear things. I know that Craig Biggio wears the Sunshine Foundation emblem on his hat as a something that he started. Has a lot to do with charity work for children in the Houston area, I believe. And he wears that on his hat all the time. Seen plenty of other players. I don't know if it's, did Cora say that this was something that they just came down and said,
well, there's
can't do it anymore?
Well, there's an edict on the bulletin board in the Mariners locker room and the visitors locker room as well that states very specifically there to be no pins, no badges, nothing out of the ordinary to be on anyone's hat or helmet. That would be out of uniform. And someone, as Cora lines it into center right at Edmonds, put very neatly underneath, now known as the Joey Cora rule. Three up, three down in the Mariners' second. They lead it 4-1. Well, fans tonight, we invite you to send your questions to us about tonight's ball game via email. The MCI Interactive Fan lets you talk to us about this game or anything else happening in Major League Baseball. Two viewers will have their questions asked and answered on the air. The email address, as you see, mci@foxsports.net. We move to the top of the third inning. Mariners enjoy a 4-1 lead. And Gary DeSarcina, the Angels shortstop, leads things off. Boy, a couple of years ago, the Angels were on their way. They were going to win the West going away, it appeared. With about a month and a half to play, they led Seattle by a whopping 11 games. Then Gary DeSarcina tore up his thumb, tore ligaments in the thumb, and the Angels collapsed, finishing the year 16-27, and of course, the one-game playoff here at the Kingdome. Andy Sheets makes a good play. DeSarcina retired for out number one.
Anybody who thinks that their collapse wasn't in direct relation to that man's injury right there is crazy. And they just went through the floor for a lot of reasons, but that was the biggest.
Yeah, he was the glue defensively for their ball club. He really played such great shortstop for them all year, and then for him to go down like he did was the cruelest blow of all for Anaheim. Tony Phillips leads it off. Marcel Lachman, of course, was the manager of the Angels at that time. Kind of an odd situation. Lachman was the pitching coach, then became the manager. Now when Terry Collins becomes the manager, Lachman goes back to becoming the pitching coach.
It's as strange as it gets in that line of business, line of work right there. Usually once you become the manager and then you're no longer the manager, you're no longer in the organization.
Phillips pops a foul back out of play into the upper deck. And Tony ahead in the count, two balls and a strike. Phillips fly to right, his first time up. Crowd settling in now at the Kingdome. Not too many empty seats. They all want to be a part of Mariner history. This is a franchise, a city that, well, for 18, 19 years, struggled and struggled and struggled. And now finally, Mariners are perennial winners. Phillips lines hard into center. Junior late break now coasting back. He's got it, and Phillips is 0-2. Jim Edmonds bats with two down. He hit a laser beam his first time.
And that ball was just a mistake by Randy Johnson. We'll see once again here as Johnson may pitch a much tougher here. He was very uncomfortable in the at-bat.
Oh, look at him bail out. Yeah. Oh, man. That was was John Kruk like, folks?
This is where you say your heart's in it, but your rear end isn't.
A ball and a strike.
Watch this. This is classic Randy Johnson. This is one of the best hitters in the game, afraid to face the pitch. As I mentioned, the home run that Edmonds hit was like the home run that I hit against John Candelaria. Closed my eyes and swung hard. Was afraid to be in the play at the box there.
One ball, two strikes. Mr. Edmonds looks like he wishes he was on the beach somewhere.
Anywhere but here.
Enjoying a pina colada or something. He laid off that, 2-2. This guy's a very exciting player.
I think Johnson's going to go hard and away.
Fastball right through the wicket into center field.
Would you like to be a guy who doesn't want to be here and you're 2-for-2 with a home run tonight? I mean, he, once again, here's a swing right here where you can see his rear end headed towards his own dugout. He just flips his bat out into the hitting zone there, just flips the ball up the middle. Not a classic Jimmy Edmonds swing, but he's 2-for-2 on the night.
And Tim Salmon, who's had a super year, standing in. Salmon with 124 runs batted in, looks for a couple more here, and he's hit 32 homers as well. Number two all time on Angels RBI list for a season. Don Baylor, of course, with 139, the franchise record. Oh, 96 mile an hour gas, didn't get it, 1-1. And Randy's still shaking his head. He's got the stuff, but tonight he can't find the location. His last start down in Texas, Bob Brentley and I saw him pitch, and he didn't have the stuff on that night. But remember, he's making just his third start since coming back from the tendonitis problem in his hand. Lou Piniella said if the Mariners can wrap it up tonight, this will probably be Randy's last start of the season. They may give him one more crack at winning 20 out of the bullpen. No Mariner, by the way, has ever won 20 games. Johnson's career high is 19 wins set a couple of seasons ago.
That was some gas right there that he threw. And as you mentioned, he does not have the great location so far in the two-plus innings we've seen him pitch. But he's gotten away with this Salmon at bat right here because he's throwing the ball past Salmon.
Breaking ball is hit hard and foul past Larry Bowler, the third base coach. And the count remains 1-2.
Hey, you talked to Tim Salmon about the lack of recognition that he gets for the season that he's put up with the RBIs and the home run numbers. He's kind of a quiet guy. He's an unassuming guy. He says, you know what, if you get the recognition, you get everything else that goes along with that, too. And there's some hassles that come along with that. I'd just soon be forgotten. I get the opportunity to spend time with my family in the offseason. I go out for a restaurant, have some dinner, and nobody knows who I am, and that suits me just fine.
Well, you'd pick a guy with the name of Sam Inwood. Enjoy hitting in Seattle.
Or else always be looking over his shoulder.
That's about right. 1-2. Back to the screen.
Time to start swimming upstream.
Let's see, there's Kevin Bass, Steve Trout, Tim Salmon. There's Tim Wallach, but not Walleye. The pitch. Line drive toward first. Mike Bauer slides, can't make the play. Nice try, but no grab.
Now here's the example of what we talked about before. You see him slide to catch the ball right here. That's the one time I don't mind doing that. If you're going to dive headfirst into a wall, that's not a very smart play. You can slide to try to make that play. Keep yourself from being injured on a play that you don't have to be injured on. That's what catchers do up against the wall. And right and left fielders will do that if they have to chase a foul ball up against the wall. But clearly by pulling back to slide, it makes the play much more difficult to catch.
Salmon breaks his bat. Blowers knocks it down, picks it up, steps on the bag, and the inning is over. No runs, one hit, one left. Stay tuned, folks. Junior is up second in the Seattle third. Seattle coming to bat in the home half of the third inning. A reminder for our X-Files friends, you will not be seeing the X-Files tonight at 8 o'clock. Major League Baseball continues tonight from the Kingdome, but don't miss tomorrow night's episode of the X-Files at 8, 9, Mountain on FX, the best prime time on cable. And stay tuned tonight after the game for a special double feature of the X-Files starting at 11, Midnight Mountain, or right after our ball game. But O'Kelly takes high, ball one. He fly to center. His first time up is 1-for-11 lifetime against Angels southpaw Alan Watson. Weak swing there, and it's popped up. Cruder gives chase and puts it away. Good play for out number one.
This is a nice play by Chad Cruder, and he knows running towards his own dugout that he's going to get some help. Starts to try to put on the brakes, then he realized, hey, I know my own guys will catch me in there. If you're running into the other dugout, you can forget about it. You'll end up hitting a wall. No one's going to go out of their way to help you out.
Well, here's Junior. He singled his first time up. How do you think he's handled the incessant questioning about the Maris chase?
I think he does a pretty good job because he's not a guy that likes to talk about himself very much anyway.
Got a fastball and took it low.
Now, Junior has his way of being short with you if he wants to. He does it in a charming, joking way, but you know when he's wants to talk more about an issue, and you know when he doesn't. And this is one that he has tried to keep the focus away from. There's Griffey's hot zone right there. You can probably color a few more of those blue ones in red the way he's swinging about right now.
He's ahead, three balls, no strikes. You saw briefly that home runs by month total. July was a terrible month for Griffey. His mother-in-law passed away, wasn't happy. The Mariners made a road trip to their minor league ball club in North Carolina. And now he walks on four pitches to open up the third inning, and the crowd not happy. They want to see him swing the bat. Funny, too. Local radio station here in Seattle sweating out the final week of the season, too. They have offered $500,000 to the major league pitcher that surrenders the 62nd home run hit by Griffey should he get that far. Give me a uniform.
I'd be the pitcher.
I'd be honored. Edgar Martinez, the hitter. One on, one out. Mariners looking to add to their lead. Edgar skips the rope, comes up and grabs that left leg. I think he's all right now. Cruder out for a chat. Five straight have missed the zone.
Well, even with the 4-1 lead, Alan Watson hasn't had his pinpoint control, that's for sure. Look at Edgar Martinez dancing out of the way of that ball. Remember we mentioned at the outset of this ball game that Watson could be sailing along and then all of a sudden just lose location. He doesn't generally lose location out of the strike zone. He usually lets the ball get out over the middle of the plate.
Griffey with 15 steals on the year. He stands at first. You see the Fox box in the upper left-hand portion of your screen. That red dot represents that man for the Mariners. Low, six in a row out of the zone. Two balls, no strikes.
Edgar, the only Mariner to have 100 runs and 100 RBIs and 100 walks in three straight seasons. You wonder why Griffey isn't part of that. Buehner also will do it, has done it this season. Griffey doesn't walk enough.
No, he doesn't need to stop at first.
That's right. Doesn't get the walks to be part of that club. Griffey right there walked this time. Only the 75th time this season. And he's been intentionally walked almost a third of those times.
24 times, I think.
23 times.
Right. Well, let's see. Griffey has 180 hits.
Yeah, Griffey just uses he's from the Chucky Carr school of hits.
He's hacking.
I'm hacking.
That's right. 82 of those 180 hits are for extra bases for Griffin. Three balls, no strikes. Edgar Martinez, whose future is somewhat in doubt here in Seattle. There's talk that the Mariners could become a National League team next year. And Edgar has said, I'd almost sooner retire than play National League style baseball. This is a man that is a third baseman by trade, but they really don't have a spot for him here.
And one of the reasons why he doesn't play third, because of the knee problems. Physically cannot go out and play the position. I mean, certainly he didn't get run off of third base because he had bad years out there. He's just had bad knees, and they don't allow him to go out and play defense.
But the Mariners organization, although not seemingly wholeheartedly endorsing a move to the National League, my feeling is, reading between the lines, they would support it for this reason alone. The Mariners travel more air miles than any team in Major League Baseball. Every year, the Mariners travel over 50,000 air miles. And if Seattle was aligned in the National League with the Dodgers, the Giants, the Padres, the Diamondbacks, it would save them a tremendous amount of travel time and expense. And, of course, would foster some great rivalries for them as well. So they might be in favor of a radical move. Three balls, two strikes. The Mariner Moose getting a little impatient here.
Well, we saw Edgar do this in his first at-bat, work the count.
Pitch swung on, double play ball to DeSarcina. Out there, nicely turned, inning over. No runs, no hits, no one left. Three innings in the books at the Kingdome. Seattle seeking the Western title as the lead. Friends, time to take a peek at tonight's MCI trivia question. With 182 hits this year, Garrett Anderson has the most ever by an Angels left-handed hitter. Whose club record did he break?
You have a guess?
I think it's two guys. That's a bit of a hint. It's not just one player, it's two players.
I'm sure of the first guy. I'm not too sure of the second one. But I'll give you my guess. When the time is right.
That's right. We'll have the answer in the bottom half of our fourth inning. 4-1 Seattle lead. Dave Holland saw it off and fouled it away.
The bat went further than the ball. And A-Rod fielded it flawlessly. Now the key is to make sure you don't go run out, see if that bat's corked. That ball is severely in Dave Holland's kitchen right there. You can see where it hits just above the hands, snaps the bat in half right about at point of contact. And that thing is...
What does that feel like?
I don't know. I never swung hard enough to break a bat. It just is a give. As soon as it hits, all of a sudden, the bat, you feel a little bit of a give, and then there's like nothing left there, so you're swinging air. And you know it's not good.
The 0-1 from Randy Johnson is taken low.
Let's take a look at Dave Holland's hit zone. You can see the cold area right there in on the hands. He doesn't like hitting that pitch. He just showed you why. Can't hit it.
Downstairs and in. Two balls and a strike from the big unit, Randy Johnson. 6'10". Is the Mariner left-hander. He had his contract extension, or option, I should say, picked up last week. He'll be a Mariner again next season. And he's a relative bargain at today's price. It's about $6 million a year.
That is a bargain.
Two balls, two strikes to Dave Hollins. He bounced out to short to end the Anaheim first. Well, you talk about a guy, Steve, that is tough. Guy in the box is tough. Found out he was a diabetic just a few years ago. Fights that every day. Plays every day. Plays hurt. You never hear a peep from him. Payoff pitch. Got him swinging.
Here's
fourth strikeout.
One of the things that Randy Johnson can make you do is swing at pitches that are out of the strike zone. You get to a point where you have a 3-2 count. You're looking for a pitch that you can at least put in play. And Johnson, because of the speed of the pitch and the arm angle, can get you to go fishing.
Ricky Henderson. Boy, they do not look comfortable at all to these Angels in the box tonight.
I'm not comfortable, and I'm sitting way up here.
Yeah, he hasn't been wild at all. He's just been very, very nasty so far in the game. That nips the outside edge. Ricky didn't like it. 1-1.
That's a rare changeup from Randy Johnson. Don't see many of those occasionally, and maybe throw four or five a night.
Well, he throws one of those, and you got to feel like you're the guy that has your six lucky lottery numbers, and the one week you don't play it, the numbers get hit. Yeah. Chin Music moves him back. 3-1. Because you're right, he does not throw many. Johnson has yet to walk a hitter in the game.
There you can see the kind of control that Randy Johnson has when he needs it. 3-1 count. Got to come back with back-to-back strikes. Now he puts himself in the position that he had Hollins in. Feel like the hitter has the advantage, but not against Johnson.
Wow, look at that defensive swing. 3-2. Are you surprised at how badly Ricky has struggled since coming over from the Padres?
Yeah, I am, because as I had mentioned before, he usually loves to be in this situation.
Got him swinging. Wow.
Time may be catching up with the best leadoff hitter that ever played.
5 punch outs for the big unit.
Now look at this pitch in the location. This is a 3-2 pitch. Nasty fastball on the knees. Let's check it out real time. Forget about it.
Aaron Anderson hits. Base is empty. 2 down. Right through there. Johnson starting to find that release point. And look at the Mariners in the outfield. Just standing around, hands on hips, as Johnson takes over the game. 0-2. He's just playing catch right now. I mean, look at the body language.
There's a guy with the most hits of any left-hander in Angel history, and he might as well put down the flag and pick up a bat.
He strikes out the side again. Friends, again, our MCI trivia question tonight. With 182 hits this year, Garrett Anderson has the most ever by an Angels left-handed hitter. Whose club record did he break? Well, Rod Carew's the obvious answer, but who's the second man?
I'll say Wally Joyner.
You are wrong. Luis Polonia. 179 hits with Rod Carew. Rod did it in 1980, Polonia in 1991. It's 4-1 Seattle in the bottom half of the fourth inning. 4 runs, 4 hits for the Mariners. A run, 3 hits for Anaheim. Alex Rodriguez, look out, folks. It's even a ball and a strike. All the other American League action is final. The National League, the big race in the National League West continues tonight. We'll update that in a moment. A-Rod sends a drive into the right center field gap. Can anybody catch up? Edmonds on the run. Can't make a play. It'll bounce off the wall. A-Rod round second. He's on his way to third. Here's the relay throw. Not in time.
nothing better when you're a hitter after you get knocked down to drive a ball into the gap. Edmonds, if he's in home in Anaheim, he dives for that ball, not here.
And the third triple for Rodriguez, who just did slide in ahead of the tag. And a belly flop slide, too. Had a little too much angle. Jay Buhner, the hitter. He has knocked in three runs with a mammoth home run his first time up. 40 homers, 109 runs batted in for Buhner. Infield in for Anaheim. And a beautiful breaking ball. Here's the Buhner homer. And he got it all. 40 home runs in three straight seasons now for the Seattle right fielder. It's 1-2. Missed. The Angel infield thought they had Buhner struck out.
Buhner's home run into the upper deck was only the 13th time ever happened here, and he's done it three times. That's a bomb way out there.
That missed high. It's 3-2. Sixth three ball count. Watson has surrendered so far in the game. And he lost it.
Now there's a definite difference in the way Buhner's approaching his at-bats right now. Second walk for Watson on the evening. We've seen him swing through some fastballs early in the year that even he thought he should hit. He went through some periods this year. The average down for Jay Buhner a little farther into the 240s than he'd like to see it. Home run numbers, the power numbers still certainly there, but he looks as comfortable as I've seen him all season long at the plate right now.
Marcel Ashman, the pitching coach for Anaheim out. And the left side of the infield for the Angels comes to the mound as well.
See, Lashman has to go out there just because Kruder, now the toothless wonder, and he tries to talk to Watson, he just spits all over him. No teeth or anything, he's just saying, boy, the fastball doesn't look too good anymore.
Sounds like Sylvester the cat.
It sounds like the way I speak all the time. Watson not real happy, takes the rosin back, throws it all over the place.
Bullpen warming again for Anaheim if necessary. Pep Harris. Oh, almost picked off one of his mates behind him with that.
They already had
the catcher. They're at the corners, nobody out for Dan Wilson, and he takes high. Wilson came over from the Reds in Lou Piniella's first year here in Seattle. At the time, it was a very unpopular deal. Mariners got Bobby Ayala and Dan Wilson in exchange for Brett Boone and Eric Hansen. Of course, Eric Hansen now a member of the Blue Jays. He's been hurt all year. Brett Boone hitting in the low 200s. Fielding the ball very well, but always a guy that strikes out a lot. And a little too much for Lou Piniella's liking.
Big swing fans, for a little guy.
I think the fans are happy with the way that trade has turned out. And an all-star catcher and a guy who's had a great comeback season in the bullpen now. The 2-0 is high, 3-0. He is all over the place.
Oh, what happens to Alan Watson sometimes is he starts throwing across his body. Gets that front lead foot, the right foot down a little bit too quick instead of opening up and letting his arm catch up with himself. See the slinging motion right there. Makes it much more difficult for him to get the ball in on right-handed hitters.
the strike. Chip Carey, Steve Lyons, our entire FX crew tonight from the beautiful Pacific Northwest and the Kingdome in Seattle. 3-1. Ooh, got the fastball by him.
Now Wilson was sitting dead red on that pitch right there, just missed it. A lot of times people think that if when you swing and miss, you took a bad swing. That's not necessarily true. It's kind of hard to hit that ball. You can put a nice swing on a pitch and not hit it. Don't like to do that too often, but it is possible.
The 3-2 pitch, swing and a miss. He swung at ball four. That's big out for Watson now.
You can put a bad swing on a pitch and miss it too, and that's what happens right here with Danny Wilson. Gets fooled by this ball. He's looking for the fastball again. He's out in front on that front foot. Really helps Watson out in that situation. Watson gets a big break with Wilson swinging at that pitch.
Well, the Mariners will go over the 3 million mark in attendance. Not tonight, but tomorrow night. They've drawn 52,884 to tonight's ballgame. Mike Flowers digs in, and they feel the first. He did not swing. Mariners for the season now, 2,995,107 paying customers.
Said they could play Major League Baseball in the Pacific Northwest.
Just think how they'll draw when they've got their new baseball stadium built right across the street here. And they can open up the roof. There's a good fastball. They even the count 1-1.
Yeah, they could open up the roof on a night like tonight. That's for sure.
Oh, exactly. Mid-70s, upper 80s. Beautiful sunshiny day today. You mentioned flying up to Seattle from Los Angeles. I came in from Florida. Just a picture perfect day. One of those days you dream about. Here in Seattle, not a cloud in the sky. And things moving along swimmingly as well inside for Seattle tonight. They've got a 4-1 lead. Their second Western Division title within their grasp. Randy Johnson on the mound. Alan Watson checking to see who covers second on a comebacker and hopes of turning a double play. Now the southpaw stretch. And a breaking ball of beauty. It's 1-2. National League scoreboard. What a Western Division roundup they're going to have. The Giants in first place, trailing in Colorado 5-3. The Padres and the Dodgers now tied at 2, that game in the fifth. Tell you what, the Rockies aren't out of it yet. They're 5.5 back. The Dodgers 2.5 back. The 1-2 now is inside. The other big news, the Florida Marlins have clinched their first playoff berth. They beat the Expos in Montreal 6-3. So the Marlins will play either the Giants or the Dodgers or the Rockies in the first round of the National League playoffs. The Braves await the Astros, who won tonight as well. Houston beat the Cubbies 5-3. The 2-2. Three called. Flowers and the fans in the stands thought that pitch was high.
Watson has really benefited, one from a bad swing, two from a bad call. I think one of the biggest problems that Alan Watson has right now is that he does not get the ball and throw it. I just timed his last three pitches, an average of 32 seconds between pitches. That's ridiculous. Get the ball and throw it.
Well, against these guys, you can understand why you wouldn't want to.
Well, I can understand that too, but I mean, at the same time, we got guys standing around out there. They're not ready to play behind you. It gets old.
Danny Sheets takes quick strike. It's 0-1. Well, Alex Rodriguez led off the inning with a sliding triple. walked. Jay Buhner walked, but Wilson and Bowers have since struck out.
It makes it awfully tough on your defense when your pitcher won't throw the ball.
Nothing and one. The pitch is a breaking ball outside.
Every count's 2-2, 3-2, 3-1. You guys get tired of standing around and waiting for the next pitch. You're not sharp.
Now Ricky Henderson out left. His bent at the waist, staring down at that AstroTurf. Pitch downstairs.
Ricky trying to find his name written in the turf out there, looking for sunflower seeds.
A couple coins,
checking
maybe.
Checking out the crowd, seeing what's happening. No reason for him to be in that situation right there. If the guy gets the ball and throws it, he doesn't have time to check out the people in the stands.
Hit hard toward third. Alessia grabs it, guns him out, and retires the side. The Mariners get him first and third with nobody out, but fail to score here in the fourth at home. Just north of town here in Seattle, just north of the Space Needle. There's the beautiful Puget Sound on the right, the Cascade and the Olympic Mountains framing this picturesque city in Seattle, Washington. The Kingdome in Seattle, the site of tonight's ball game. And Luis Alcia leads it off in the fifth against Randy Johnson, who has punched out 6 men in the game, has the 4-1 lead as Jay Buhner hit his 40th home run in the first to erase a 1-0 Anaheim advantage. And the crowd, Steve, rocking and rolling and very loud and raucous early on. Now kind of settling in and watching Randy Johnson get into a groove here.
I think tonight we're seeing a picture of two different pitchers. You see Johnson gets the ball, gets ready, gets a sign and throws it. Alan Watson's been in trouble all night. That tends to slow you down a little bit.
Popped a mile high. Who wants it? Mike Flowers makes the call, and he's got it. And Alessia is retired. You know, it's interesting. We've seen the Mariners the last couple of years. Last season, it seemed that this was a bit more of a happy-go-lucky bunch. Last year, of course, Texas won the American League's Western Division. This year, the Mariners, a much more business-like approach to things. Does that come with the expectations of being a championship-caliber ball club, you think? Base hit by Chad Kruder with one out.
Well, I think not only that. I think they were certainly coming into the season expected to win. But the problems that they've had, I think that the consistent bullpen problems that they have had this season, not only was in the minds of the guys that pitch out of the bullpen, but it was in the minds of every guy on this team. No lead was safe. And when they got a lead, they always had to think, you know, does the starter have to go nine? What's going to happen when we go down there? And they blew so many games. Got to be a major concern for this team.
Of late, though, the Mariner bullpen has been one of their strengths. And no, I'm not kidding. They've pitched very, very well down there since the trade. Arcina down two strikes, nothing and two.
And I'll say now what I was going to wait to say during the playoffs. I believe that Seattle will be in the playoffs, and I think that their bullpen will pitch much better in the playoffs.
Well, Bobby Ayala has been their most consistent guy. His ERA under two since the 1st of August. Heathcliff Slocum saved 9 of 10 games when given the opportunity for the Mariners. And Mike Timlin has given up just one run in his last 10 games for Seattle. When you factor in Johnson, Fassero, and Moyer, all of a sudden what was a glaring weakness for the Seattle ball club might prove to be a very solid help for them in the postseason. Double play ball there, and it's beautifully turned by A-Rod. And the inning is over. No runs, one hit, nobody left. We're halfway home at the Dome. 4-1 Seattle. first MCI Interactive fan question. It's a rather interesting query from Steve McGowan from Chico, California. Why won't the media leave Junior alone? Well, what are they supposed to do? The guy's got 55 home runs, for crying out loud.
Yeah, part of their job is to come in and talk to the players before and after the ball games. I think Junior gets treated very well by the media. I think he handles the media very well. I think it's a pretty harmonious situation right and left. I don't know if the questioner there knows something that we don't, but I would assume that he does not. And I think that both guys handle, the media and Junior, handle the situation very well.
I think fans sometimes forget, as Joey correlates things off, were it not for the media publicizing the great feats of some of these players, probably, almost certainly, the players wouldn't be earning the great numbers of dollars, and
yeah, most of us wouldn't care about it.
That's exactly right. Cora lines it down the left field line. So I think it's a hand-in-hand situation. As long as the media is respectful of what Griffey is trying to accomplish,
and sometimes they're not.
And sometimes they're not. But I think in this case they have been, and I don't think Junior has a problem with it. I think it's the age-old adage, and I'm sure you'd agree. It's like when someone asks you for your autograph. Time to be frustrated or worried about it is not when they ask you, but when they stop asking you.
That's right. That's why I say, if you want to take the time and ask me for it, I'll sign it.
Two balls and a strike to Joey Cora, and he takes strike two.
I'll tell you, one of the things that came up in the conversation earlier with Lou Piniella, we talked about all the guys in the lineup with the home runs.
Cora lines it into center, his second hit of the game.
I asked Lou, you know, who in this lineup has surprised you with their power, and he just started laughing and said, Joey Cora. Number of home runs that kid has hit, 11 home runs. The guy doesn't weigh more than a flea.
He looks like he's...
I mean, that Band-Aid doubles his weight.
He looks like a guy that is wearing a cartoon mustache and he doesn't know how to put it on right.
Yeah, that's right. That's what they used to say about Jody Reed when he had his mustache. Looked like a 12-year-old dressing up on Halloween.
Roberto Kelly takes a strike. He's 0-2 in the game. Why has he bounced around so much?
Look at all the teams. Well, like I said, look at some of the ball clubs that he has played for. A couple of them he just didn't have a good fit.
Line, great grab, Alisea at third.
I just think when you put that kid in a lineup that's very powerful, like the one he's playing in right now, he can blossom.
But you got to remember, he used to be known as Bobby Kelly, so Roberto Kelly really hasn't played for that many teams. Bobby Kelly's played for four or five of them.
Yeah, so now he'll probably start getting some better pitches to hit because nobody really knows who he is.
Well, that's something the fans hope to have happen here. Junior walked on four pitches last time up, singled and scored in the first.
Gonna be hearing some booing here if they don't throw him a strike this time.
Oh, he got away with a pitch up in the zone that time. Nothing and one. 145 ribbies for Junior. Fastball missed away. It's one and one.
Now, earlier on in the season, Alan Watson was standing on the rubber way off to the third base side. They've tried to get him adjust. You can see by the picture right there, he's all the way on the first base side of the rubber now.
Home run cut, he missed it, one and two. Boy, when he swings, it's like a firefly convention. All the flash bulbs are popping as the pitch is delivered.
And the reason they did that was for that pitch right there. We'd have a better chance. See him going all the way over to the first base side of the rubber there. You can see in front of his foot off to the right is where he drags his foot. He's even a good foot past the rubber when he actually drags his foot on the way to home plate. The reason they tried to do that is to get him to throw that last pitch that he just threw to Junior, the one low and away to the lefties and the one down and in to the righties. They felt like he had better control and could maneuver his body better and hit that spot much more consistently.
And he swings and he strikes out. So the third Watson strikeout, two outs here in the fifth. Cora remains at first.
See the location. You see where catcher is sitting up way outside. That's a tough pitch to hit, and that's the pitch that he wants to throw. Junior just can't go out and get that one. Cruder, perfect location, and Watson hits the spot.
So it's up to Edgar Martinez if Seattle is to add to the 4-1 lead. Two outs in the fifth. We're zipping right along at the Kingdome. Edgar has bounced to first, and he's hit to a 6-3 double play. How do you pitch to this guy? This box isn't all right. Well, there's a couple of holes in his swing, I suppose.
Yeah, Edgar doesn't usually like the ball right up there on his hands, and because he has an inside-out swing for the most part, unless he's thinking pull, that ball down and in gives him a little trouble, too.
Breaking ball, hammer down the right field line, and he slices it foul and out of play. Two-time batting champion Edgar Martinez. Frank Thomas is seeking his first batting title with the White Sox, in case you wonder who's leading. And there's a strike. Thomas at 352, Edgar at 332 with a week to play. It looks like Frank has that all but wrapped up.
That's amazing to think of a guy like Frank Thomas. 240, 250, 260 pounds maybe, leading the league in hitting.
33 home runs as well, 121 runs batted in. With 107 walks, he has the highest on base percentage. Does Thomas? He'll get some MVP voting. The 0-2 is wrapped foul. Well, I guess there are really three major candidates, Thomas being one of them for the AL MVP. Early in the season, Tino Martinez appeared to be a runaway choice. He had 34 of those 139 runs batted in April. He, too, has had a fantastic season.
Look at the numbers these guys are throwing up. Those are careers for some people. Don't say it.
I can think it, though. But I have said for several years that we are really seeing an offensive renaissance in the game of baseball. When you think about those kinds of numbers being put up, not just 1 or 2 years in a row, but 3, 4, 5 years in a row, that's really something to behold. Indians tonight have clinched the AL Central. They beat the Yankees 10-9. Had to
pitchers
come back
cool
to do it. Yeah, had to come back and win it at the Jake. So the Indians are champions of the Central. They will, in all likelihood, play Baltimore. The Orioles were winners in Toronto 3-2 tonight. Expand their lead to 4 over New York. Edgar sends a drive into shallow center. On comes Evans, still coming. And he made the grab and retires Edgar and the Mariners. No runs, a hit, a man left in the fifth. 4-1, Seattle the lead. +52,000 on hand at the Kingdome. Mariners 4, Angels 1, and Friends Only FX brings you the best prime time and cable. Weeknights, if there's no ball game, the action starts at 8, 7 Central with The X-Files. After The X-Files, stay tuned at 9, 8 Central for NYPD Blue. Then it's The Outrageous in living color at 10, 9 Central. The best prime time on cable is only on FX, Fox, Gone Cable. Top of the order for Anaheim in the sixth. Innings and outs becoming scarce commodities against Randy Johnson. Tony Phillips takes a quick strike. He's flying to right. He is flying to center. So he looks for his first hit against the big unit, and he pumps the serious gas right through there for 0-2.
Tony clearly the catalyst on this ball club, hitting in the leadoff spot. Needs to get on base for this team to do anything. tonight with the two weak pop flies. Wow, that was a pitch that got away from Randy Johnson, trying to get it up in the zone. Mr. Snappy, as he calls it.
John Kruk didn't like Mr. Snappy very much.
Not a lot of guys like Mr. Snappy.
Harry Walker didn't either.
There's
and
Mr.
Phillips
Snappy.
Did not go. Got a break at first. John Hirschbeck says Phillips did not swing, so the count's even 2-2.
Well, if the Angels go to the National League, what do you think that would be right there?
Have a seat time.
Have a seat. American League's a little more lenient with their strike recalls on a check swing.
Phillips with the old emergency hack there, stays alive, 2-2.
Well, certainly the whole Phillips situation with the accusation of drug use, certainly a distraction to this ball club to go along with the injuries at a bad time during the pennant chase for this ball club when everything started to go awry for the club. I talked to Tony about that situation. He says, hey, the only thing I can do is go out and play well, because if I don't, everybody's going to be on my back. It's the only way I can prove that I don't have a problem, that I can get it taken care of and try to get fans back on my side, is go out, keep my mouth shut, and go out and play good baseball.
Which he's done.
Payoff pitch. Slider. Got him looking. Phillips can't believe it.
And he may get run out of this game.
And he may get run not for himself, but for his team.
Take Tony Phillips much in a situation like this. Good sign is that he's walking away.
There may not be a better instigator in baseball. Phillips knows they got to get something going against Randy Johnson, and maybe this will fire up his mates.
I got to tell you, I think that's a pretty good pitch. He's arguing that it's down, but look at how low Tony Phillips stands in the box, and that's a pretty nasty pitch on the knees. And Randy Johnson has been there pretty consistently all night.
And give Jim McKean some credit too. You know, the zero tolerance policy in effect by Major League umpires this season. We've seen players run for a lot less than that. And McKean, knowing the gravity of the situation for both teams, knows Phillips is a key player, let him have his say, and Tony walked away. And he stayed in the game. Good show of restraint by Phillips and by McKean there.
Well, I'll tell you, I mean, Phillips was very animated, very excited. But to me, a good umpire will always be a guy who will let you have your say. I mean, every umpire knows that they do miss calls occasionally. It upsets the players. But the best umpires will let you say what you have to say and then say, all right, you've said it. I'm not changing the call. Now go sit down. And then if you keep after him, that's when you're going to get run.
Inside, almost hit Edmonds. 3 balls and a strike.
Now, no disrespect to Jimmy Edmonds here, but this guy has 2 hits on the evening, and he's looked as bad as I've ever seen him look at the plate.
Swung on, hammered deep toward right center field. That ball's way out of here. Edmonds is 3 out of 3, Steve, with 2 home runs.
And they threw the ball back onto the field. This guy's having a career night.
He was 2 for 13 against Johnson coming in, and now 9 and 10 home runs hit against Randy Johnson by left-hand hitters over his career, 2 of them tonight.
Look at the way he's bailing out right here. Look at his feet falling out of the strike zone, out of the batter's box. Randy's just making some mistake pitches at the wrong time to Jimmy Edmonds, and he's making him pay for every one of them.
Tim Salmon pops it out of play, nothing in one, and the man who's hotter than anything on that Anaheim bench is Tony Phillips. He thought he had coaxed a walk, and if he had done so, the Edmonds home run would have made it a one-run game. But it's 4-2 now, and the slider missing low, a ball and a strike. So how about this game? Edmonds, with just four home runs against southpaws all year, hits two tonight against Randy Johnson, who over the course of his big league career had given up just eight home runs to left-handed hitters.
And I'll tell you, now he certainly made me look bad, because I've been sitting there saying how bad he looks at the plate. I don't think I'm wrong. I mean, I've seen some bad swings up there. I don't think he's very comfortable. He certainly is getting his bat on the ball when he needs to. His second hit the ball up the middle. He just flipped his bat at. His first home run was a mistake, and that ball he was bailing out of the way. Just got the good part of the bat head on the ball and yanked it into the right field seats.
Count full now, 3-2 to Salmon. One in, one out in the Anaheim sixth. Salmon tries to protect the plate. The payoff. Fouled off his body.
Let's take a look at Edmonds' swing again. Look at his feet. Watch how there's so much movement of his feet. His back foot comes up off the ground, bailing out of the box, but he gets the bat head through the zone. He's got so much power and strength, he accidentally hits the ball out of the yard.
That's the old bail and whale, isn't it?
Oh, man.
Breaking ball, Salmon wraps it into foul ground.
Of course, maybe I'm just spending the next 5 minutes trying to cover my own rear end. Maybe this guy knows exactly what he's doing out there, and I'm clueless, which, you know, wouldn't be the first time. I'm asking him after the game, though. I know he doesn't feel comfortable at the plate. Nobody does. Out against Johnson.
Salmon may have broken his bat. Pops to Cora at second. Two down. Well, we got a ball game again. It's two-run affair here. Dave Hollins, who looks for his first hit tonight. Edmonds has three of the five Anaheim hits and both runs and RBIs.
I think you hit it right on the head earlier in the game, Chip, when you said that the velocity is pretty much there with Johnson. The slider is breaking fairly nastily tonight, but it's all about location with Randy Johnson. Both balls that ended up in the seats off of Edmonds' bats were balls that were up in the strike zone and out over the middle of the plate where Edmonds can handle both of them. He hasn't had his tremendous pinpoint control. You know what happens is Randy Johnson sets the standard for himself by being so good so often that when he's just normal out there, a tough left-handed pitcher to hit, we think he's having a bad night.
Foul, two balls and a strike to Hollins. If you had to pick, Steve, one guy to win game seven of the World Series for you, who would it be?
Tough not to pick that guy right there. Tommy Glavine.
Pedro Martinez, Greg Maddux. He's the big unit. Spears that Hollins drive and throws him out. Jim Edmonds hits his second solo home run of the night. It cuts the Mariner lead to 4-2 after 5.5. Well, friends, this Saturday on Fox Saturday Baseball, game of the week, the final weekend of the regular season. Catch the Dodgers and the Rockies from Coors Field. The Padres and Giants, key games in the National League Western race. Ryan Sandberg plays his final games as a Chicago Cub in St. Louis. And, of course, the Yankees battle the Tigers. Check local listings for the game and time in your area. Join Steve Lyons and yours truly, Chip Carey, with the pregame show after In the Zone this weekend on Fox. 4-2 is our score. Entering the bottom of inning number six, A-Rod Alex Rodriguez leads it off. He'll be followed by Jay Buhner and Dan Wilson. Alan Watson hanging in there. DeSarcina makes the play. He spins 360 and Hollins can't dig it out at first. And A-Rod scampering down that first baseline comes up lame. Did he turn an ankle or pull a hamstring?
Looks like he's limping like it's an ankle. You see the play by DeSarcina. You see him spinning around. This is the correct way to make the play. Looks like he scuffed his foot a little bit right there. Ooh. And didn't quite get turned all the way around.
Yeah, he hit the side of the bag.
It's a tough play because you have to try to avoid the first baseman, but you hit the bag on the side right there. It's very easy to turn that ankle like he did right there. Now he rolled that over pretty good, too.
So he's going to have a tender tootsie for a couple of days. They have ruled that play an error on DeSarcina on the low throw to first.
That's a tough error right there.
Yeah, it is a tough error. A-Rod, I think, is going to stay in the game. Rick Griffin, the fine trainer of the Mariners, is out to make sure he is all right. Well, while they do that, we'll remind you once again, friends, NYPD Blue will not be seen tonight. Don't miss tomorrow night's episode of NYPD Blue at 9, 10 Mountain. A priest will be found murdered in a park frequented by prostitutes, and Kelly and Robin become lovers. A thrilling episode of NYPD Blue tomorrow night.
Well, I think the smartest thing to do is keep A-Rod in the game right here. If it's not serious, keep him moving around. Try to keep the swelling out of that ankle. As soon as you sit down and do nothing, things going to balloon up on him.
Jay Buhner, the hitting hero for the Mariners tonight. Boy, what a poke he had in the first inning. His 40th home run of the year. That erased, well, it didn't erase it. It was a 1-1 game. It gave the Mariners a 4-1 lead. It's now a 4-2 game. Buhner pops it foul out of play. What a prestigious list Buhner has joined with three consecutive 40 home run seasons. Babe Ruth, he's a Hall of Famer. Jimmy Fox, Ralph Kiner, Eddie Matthews, yep. Ted Kluszewski, Duke Snyder, Ernie Banks, Harmon Killebrew, Hondo, Frank Howard. It's a pretty exclusive company for the Seattle Mariner right fielder, Jay Buhner. Off Watson, he's hurt. Saya flips to second in time, and they get Alex Rodriguez. That shot ricocheted off Watson, and it's dueling trainer duties here in the sixth inning.
Well, Watson right there is pulling the Jake LaMotta, saying, I never went down. Watch him. He takes the shot right off the foot. He wants to fall down, but no. No way. I can take your best shot, and I'm going to stay in the game. Maybe he's not going to stay in the game. Yeah, he is. He's saying, hey, that's no big deal. I think he got it off the bottom of his cleat. I'll tell you what, that's an iffy situation as far as where the ball hits you. If you turn your ankle just a little bit more, catches you on the bone, turn it the other way, gets you off the bottom of your shoe. Let's hear what it sounded like when it hit his foot. Like it hurt.
Yeah. It looked like it hurt too.
Hurt me, and I'm sitting way up here. As we talked about this in the very first week of the season, baseball's not really noted as a real macho game. But when someone hits a ball back up the middle and hits the pitcher, the last thing he wants to do is come out of the game, because then your teammates will be saying, oh, can't stay in the game.
Is
after
she
someone,
okay?
Is she all right?
Right. You guys are brutal. Runner at first, one out. And Wilson, the hitter. And he takes outside. And is 0-4-2 tonight. It's low. Of course, could be a history-making night for the Mariners. This, of course, an interesting date in baseball history as well.
What would that be exactly?
I'll tell you in just a minute. The 2-0 is a strike. Well, this date, 1908. I think we talked about this the last time we were in Seattle. Merkel's boner, Fred Merkel, who used to play for the old New York Giants. Today he committed one of the most famous gaffes in baseball history. The 2-1. A little swinging bunt. That's foul ball. Kruder pounced on it, but it's ruled a foul ball. I thought it was fair.
Yeah, I bet if this was if the race here was a little bit closer, I bet you'd get more of an argument out of Chad Kruder about this play right here. Hops out like a cat in front of the box. This ball, if it stays in fair territory, see where Kruder picks it up. Yeah, might have been foul. Give the umpire the benefit of the doubt on that. It's closer to the play than we were.
Yeah, remember, home plate is in fair territory. The Lions come back to form the point right at home plate, but it was ruled foul. The count now 2-2 to Wilson. Good stop by the Angel backstop. Well, the Giants, Fred Merkel, in a crucial game against the Cubs back in 1908, Steve, failed to touch second base as the apparent winning run scored. The Cubs argued the play with the umpire at the time, Hank O'Day. He later declares the game a tie. Merkel's boner. Pop up down the right side. Collins nears the camera well and runs out of real estate.
Now, if I remember correctly, that wasn't the only boner of the game for Merkel. I don't remember exactly what it was. I remember he had two big mistakes in that game. You'll enlighten me on the second one.
What are you talking about?
You told me last time we talked about Merkel that he actually had two mistakes in that game. It wasn't just one.
Wilson lines a shallow fly into right field. That's going to drop for a hit. Two on, one out. Buehner stops at second. This pitch got in his kitchen in a serious manner, but he showed off a nice piece of hitting.
Well, good hitters get jammed, and that ball is in his kitchen, and he just dunks it over the second baseman's head. Looks like a line drive in the paper tomorrow, and it's a crucial time to be coming up with a hit like that, too.
So two on, one out. The M's look for some insurance. That gets the Anaheim bullpen busy again. Pep Harris is up, although not throwing at the moment. Swung on and hammered straightaway center. Back goes Edmonds. He's got room. Tagging at second, moving to third is Buehner. And there's out number two. If Mike pulls that ball, it's in the seats.
That ball just got in on Blowers a little bit. Didn't quite get it out on the meat of the bat. A long ways to hit it here in Seattle, 405 to dead center.
Saying, oh, fiddlesticks. And Alex Rodriguez continues to test that right ankle. First and third, two outs. Yesterday, in this day in baseball history. What are you talking about?
You told me last time we talked about Merkel that he actually had two mistakes in that game. It wasn't just one.
Wilson lines a shallow fly into right field. That's going to drop for a hit. Two on, one out. Buehner stops at second. This pitch got in his kitchen in a serious manner, but he showed off a nice piece of hitting.
Well, good hitters get jammed, and that ball is in his kitchen, and he just dunks it over the second baseman's head. Looks like a line drive in the paper tomorrow, and it's a crucial time to be coming up with a hit like that, too.
So two on, one out. The M's look for some insurance. That gets the Anaheim bullpen busy again. Pep Harris is up, although not throwing at the moment. Swung on and hammered straightaway center. Back goes Edmonds. He's got room. Tagging at second, moving to third is Buehner. And there's out number two. If Mike pulls that ball, it's in the seats.
That ball just got in on Blowers a little bit. Didn't quite get it out on the meat of the bat. A long ways to hit it here in Seattle, 405 to dead center.
Saying, oh, fiddlesticks. And Alex Rodriguez continues to test that right ankle. first and third, two outs. Yesterday, in this day in baseball history, Cy Young won his 511th game, the last in his illustrious Major League career. That's amazing, isn't it?
He never won a Cy Young Award.
That's absolutely right. They ought to rename it, by the way, to the Greg Maddux Award.
Why not? He's going to get another one this year.
Very well could. First and third, two outs. Andy Sheets, the hitter, has yet to hit it out of the infield. And it's upstairs. Maddux has a shot at 20 wins. Danny Nagel for the Braves already has 20. I asked Tony Gwynn when we were in San Diego a couple of weeks ago, who would you vote for the Cy Young Award? He said, no question about it, Pedro Martinez in Montreal.
Same thing that McGuire said.
1-0 to Sheets, right through there, the off-speed pitch, and he took it.
Well, it's the same old story. Playing in Montreal, the team doesn't make the playoffs. The baseball team doesn't score very many goals, so nobody cares about you up there. And if you don't score goals in Montreal, you're not winning any postseason awards.
How are the Expos on the power play? No 1-1.
Not good enough.
Not good enough. That's right. 2-1 is the count to young third baseman Andy Sheets. Jay Buhner, the runner at third. Dan Wilson, the Mariner catcher, is at first.
Every time there's a power play in Montreal, that player ends up playing for somebody else.
The 2-1. Swing and a miss.
Well, there's a good changeup that we've been waiting to see all night from Alan Watson. Probably his best pitch in a crunch time situation. Once again, see him standing there on the mound, taking his time.
Look out, folks. Ready to party here at the Kingdome.
Just give them a reason.
52,884. Mariners are about 6,000 short of 3 million attendees on the year. They'll get that tomorrow in the series finale. The 2-2. Swung on and chopped foul past third this time. See if the ball girl can make the play. Oh, with a bare hand.
See, that's not good when you're playing. You foul a ball down the third baseline and the ball person down there, bare hands, your best stuff. That's just showing you up.
Well, maybe you ought to hit a rope down there and see if she can handle a hot smash.
I'd throw a changeup right here.
Fastball. Good call, Syke, to short. Out at second, and that retires the side. No runs, one hit, two left. We're through six on this historic night in Seattle. We head to the seventh, 4-2, Seattle the lead. Here at the Kingdome, don't miss FX Major Movie Sunday at 8, 9 Mountain for a major Hollywood movie every Sunday night. This Sunday, Steve, Brandon Lee battles the mob in the explosive flick, Rapid Fire. Don't miss the action this Sunday at 8, 9 Mountain on FX Major Movie Sunday. Ricky Henderson, Garrett Anderson, Luis Alisea will try to do what Jim Edmonds has done tonight. That is, hit a couple home runs and score a couple of runs. Anaheim needs two to tie. Randy Johnson, the big unit, whose next pitch unofficially will be number 100 in the game. Ricky has struck out twice on the night. And Johnson, seeking his eighth strikeout of the evening, misses low, 1-0. Anderson came over August 13th from San Diego, and quite frankly has not played well offensively for the Angels. There's a strike. Last thing Johnson wants to do is issue a walk to this guy. He's baseball's all-time stolen base artiste.
Well, Henderson sat out the last three ball games because of the slump. Just six for his last 57 coming into tonight.
If that's fair, that's trouble. It's not, so it's not. 2-2. Johnson will throw a lot of pitches. Lou said tonight he'll go as long as the big unit feels up to the task. And you know he wants to try to finish this thing out if he can.
Yeah, and his first start back, they limited him to 75 pitches. The next time, 105 pitches. And he said this time, hey, we'll let him go. He can throw 130 pitches. He does it all the time. He's going to be right up around that mark if he finishes this ball game, maybe more.
Come on.
Ricky's about ready to get tossed out of this game, too.
And Jim McKean is using all the restraint he has. And Terry Collins talking to the umpire as well. Just making sure he's protecting his players. Look at the pitch.
Well, once again, it's that slider. That's just not a bad pitch right there. Ricky bends way over, doesn't like the ball. That's underneath his belt. That's a strike. A lot of times you can get thrown out just for dropping your bat at the home plate like that.
Well, Henderson has the hat trick working so far. He's struck out all three times, and now Jim McKean's finally had enough. He's finally had enough. Terry Collins might get run for good measure here.
Well, like I said before, a good umpire will let you have your say and then tell you to get out of here. And that's exactly what McKean did. And then he kept hearing it from the bench and from the dugout. And he can only take so much. Ricky doesn't want to leave. Ricky didn't realize that he was thrown out of the game.
So play cannot resume until Henderson is exiled to the clubhouse. Terry Collins over to expedite matters here.
You think Ricky's asking him out for dinner after the game?
So Henderson ejected in the seventh.
Because I'm going down to the Metropolitan Grill after the game, and I'm just wondering if I'd see both those guys down there.
You might see them, but they probably won't be dining together. Ball and a strike to Garrett Anderson. He has struck out twice. Remember, he's got a 10-game hit streak on the line tonight.
Now, last at bat, he had no chance against Johnson. He was just waving at the ball.
He struck out twice on six total pitches. It's 2-2. Randy Johnson with eight punch outs in the game. Make it nine. They're starting to feel it now, Sykes.
Well, if anybody's got a sense of humor on that Anaheim bench, they'll just slide up to Garrett and say, hey, I know you have the 10-game hitting streak and all that, but I've seen better swings in a backyard, my man.
So Johnson now the AL leader in strikeouts by two over Roger Clemens, who had 11 tonight. But Toronto lost to Baltimore. 3-2, the final score. Luis Alcea has one of the five Anaheim hits. Randy Johnson has been overpowering tonight. The Angels have not liked Jim McKean's strike zone, but give the arbiter credit. He's had a very consistent strike zone all night tonight. And he's
heard a lot of grumbling and griping, and he's let the Angels, for the most part, have their say. Alisea has his second hit.
A lot of the strikes that they complained about look like pretty good pitches.
National League scoreboard, the Rockies trying to get back into the race. They came in tonight trailing the San Francisco Giants by 5.5 games. They have been red hot. That game now on the ninth, the Rockies have won three straight. If they win, they would be 4.5 back. The Dodgers winning over San Diego 4-2 in the eighth. They could be 1.5 back and are trying to snap a 5-game losing streak. A strike to Chad Kruder on the inside corner.
You know what happens is, even though Randy Johnson hasn't had his great location, he still has his good stuff. And some of the Anaheim hitters are more mad at Randy Johnson than any of the strike calls that are being made. And you can't yell at Randy Johnson, so you take your frustration out on the umpire.
Well, you know with this guy, you got to go up there and hack away. And especially the way that McKean has kept the strike zone tonight. Johnson has him set up. He looks for his 82nd 10 strikeout game in his big league career. Fastball high, throw to second, not in time. Alisea steals the base. A base hit means a run.
That's just a great jump. Good ball to throw. Alisea just had a tremendous jump off of Johnson. Not worried about the runner, worried about getting the hitter.
One and two. Now time is called. Johnson and Wilson want to get together on the signs with the runner at second base. The crowd on its feet at the Kingdome in Seattle. Randy Johnson trying to strike out the side for the third time in the game.
So many times when Johnson pitches that they don't have a guy on second base, so when they finally get someone out there, you have to come out and reiterate what the signs are so he doesn't forget.
Kruder held up. It's 2-2. Sarcino waiting on deck. Angels threatening here in the seventh. 4-2 Mariner game. Randy Johnson looking for strikeout number 10.
Oh. 9-1-1.
Please, Paul, help. Hit my bat.
Help is on the way. This is, whoops. Excuse me. That ball is so far in your kitchen, it's into the refrigerator grabbing a Coke.
Again, the 2-2 pitch from Randy Johnson. Way outside, it's full now. Another bad one puts the tying run aboard here in the seventh inning. No activity in the Mariner bullpen.
Yeah, I think Johnson will throw a slider here. 3-2. Kruder looking for a fastball. Johnson's had great control of the slider all night. DeSarcina on deck. Base open. Get the strikeout.
Runner goes. 3-2 pitch. He struck him out. The serious gas strikes out the side. In the seventh. There's the Space Needle in downtown Seattle, Washington. They're going to be rocking in the streets tonight if the score holds. 4-2, Seattle has the lead heading to the home half of the seventh inning. I'm Chip Carey along with Steve Psycho Lyons. Ricky Henderson's been thrown from the game, so Orlando Palmeiro comes into play right field. Garrett Anderson moves from right field to left field. And the new pitcher is burly right-hander Pep Harris. The top of the Seattle order hitting here in the seventh. All that hasn't happened for Seattle so far tonight is Ken Griffey Jr. Hasn't hit a home run yet, but he's going to have a crack here in the seventh against Harris. Joey Cora has a couple of hits tonight, has scored a run, has also lined out to center field. That's left-handed for the first time in the game. A lefty and a righty working in the Anaheim bullpen. We might see the left-hander face Griffey here in the seventh. Cora did not swing in the count now, one ball and two strikes.
Bullpen still with some action. Mike James, he of the bat sideburns and Pierce Tung, and Michael Holtz, the lefty. Harris has got a good hard sinker. Best pitch is his curveball. There it is.
And he showed it to you right there. Good call, Psycho. One down in the seventh.
Sometimes as a hitter, you just know it's strike three and you can't do a thing about it. Jelly legged him a little bit. He goes to have a seat without arguing, by the way. Just can't pull the trigger. He knows it's strike three. It says, all right, I'll tip my hat this time.
So Alan Watson's evening concluded. Six innings, seven hits, four runs. He walked two, struck out three, and gave up the long Jay Buhner home run. Roberto Kelly takes a steer, right call. Kelly tonight 0 for 3. Mariners hitting in the seventh, seeking some insurance. They have a 4-2 advantage. And it's low. Well, if things hold to form, the Mariners win the West. Baltimore, it would appear, is going to win the East. The Yankees will win the wild card. Mariners.
Is the wild card something you win?
Or you fall into, if you want to look at it that way.
Good enough.
How do you like the Mariners and the Orioles matchup?
Wow. I think that's the best matchup in the American League.
Kelly lays off. 2-2. Well, it's not like you have that many choices. I mean, you have the Indians and the Yankees, and that's it.
I know, but I don't know, in my opinion, those are the two best clubs. One of them isn't going to make it to the American League Championship Series.
2-2. A hanging breaking ball. He got away with it, though.
With all due respect to the Yankees and the Cleveland Indians.
Two outs. Harris will be pulled. Terry Collins will pitch to Junior, but he's going to make him hit the lefty.
Like he cares. It doesn't matter.
So Harris comes on, works two-thirds of an inning. Strikes out both men he faces. No hits, no runs. Mike Holtz will come on and face Junior in the seventh. 4-2, bases empty for Seattle here at the Kingdome.
Applying for a home equity loan can be confusing, but it doesn't have to be. When you apply for a loan at First Plus Financial, you get your own personal loan officer to help you step by step throughout the entire loan process. And since First Plus offers loans up to the value of your home and more, your personal loan officer can work with you one-on-one to understand your situation and get the right loan to meet your needs. So call 1-800-510-PLUS. At First Plus, we're working first for you.
Your nephew, what could he be up to right now? Hanging out, pondering the mysteries of the universe, growing up much too fast. Well, now's the perfect time to find out. MCI introduces 5 cent Sundays. 5 cents a minute. Every minute of every Sunday, if you're an MCI customer. And if not, call 1-800-SUNDAYS to become one.
Friends, our MCI Interactive fan, we invite you to send your baseball questions via email to mci@foxsports.net. We've answered one question so far tonight. We look forward to hearing from another great fan tonight here at the Kingdome in Seattle. Chip Carey, Steve Lyons, and Mariner fans, young and old, enjoying the proceedings so far. There's the new Angel pitcher, Mike Holtz.
good job out of the bullpen this year.
Yes, he has done a nice job for this team. Pretty good breaking ball. Gets his fastball up around 90 miles an hour occasionally. He's got the good curveball, especially the lefties.
And the book on Junior has always been, Steve, he's one of the better players in the game against left-handed pitchers. You give this guy a fastball, lefty or righty, he's going to make you pay for it.
And if you throw him a big sweeping breaking ball that hangs just a little bit, and put that one in the seats too. He doesn't, you know, I would think that he would prefer to hit a right-hander. He certainly does. His numbers don't fall off against the lefties. Sometimes hitters will, when they're going good, they think their concentration is better against the lefty because they feel like it has to be. Have to concentrate a little bit harder on the release point. Just because, as a left-handed hitter, when you see a ball coming from a left-handed pitcher, everything is coming at you and then breaking away from you. Nothing breaks into you.
Breaking ball, Kruger knocks it down. One ball, no strikes.
Get the feeling that a lot of pitches up there can actually hit you because the ball starts on your side of the plate.
Junior talking to Kruger and the umpires. Yeah, that wasn't even close, man. Give me a chance to swing at something. 1-0. Didn't get it. A ball and a strike.
He tried to make sure that he didn't owe Buehner dinner. He's being out-homered by Buehner on the evening, 1-0.
Is empty, two outs. Junior seeking number 56. No 1-1. Big Laredo breaking ball, and he missed with it. It's 2-1. Those folks in the right field seats better get the glove hand ready just in case. The 2-1. Fastball. Ooh, we had a cut. He missed it. 2-2.
Well, this ball got past Junior. Doesn't see it. You don't see that happen very often when he's at the plate. A little bit more movement out of him and see right at the point of contact there. Ball actually gets past his bat before he was ready to hit it.
Now they move away. The 2-2 pitch instead won't be made as Holtz steps off. When Junior's really going good, he can take the ball in the outer half of the plate and drive it over the boards in left. Now Kruger wants to talk it over.
Let's take a look at guys that have hit the most home runs in a single season. Of course, Roger Maris in 61 had 61. Look at the years here, 27, 1921, Babe Ruth, two times there. You know, back in those years, even though I wasn't around, you certainly don't hear people talking about a juice ball then. Why is it that the pitching was better then than it is right now? But these guys were still able to hit 58, 59, 61 home runs.
Well, yeah, that's why I think the whole juice ball thing is really kind of ridiculous. You still have to hit it. It's the toughest thing in all of sports to do, hit a round ball with a round bat. The 2-2 pitch is low and away. Three balls, two strikes, and a ball that's moving at you.
I think the history of the game of baseball lends itself to trying to say that the players of a latter era were better than they are today.
A 3-2 pitch to Junior. Breaking ball, bouncer towards second. Tony Phillips fields, flips, and retires the side. No runs, no hits. Nobody left. We go to the eighth. 4-2 Mariners. The eighth. Randy Johnson has punched out 10 Angels in the ballgame. How does he rank, Steve, all time in double-digit strikeout performances, I wonder? I know you've been researching the statistic most of the day today.
Yes, that's what I spent most of my time doing. You see, as you can see, as I would have told you, he ranks fourth all time.
Tie Steve Carlton tonight. Not mistaken, too, on this date in baseball history. A few years back, Steve Carlton won his 300th Major League game. Ironically enough, beating his former team, the St. Louis Cardinals.
They're just a wealth of no.
is true. Line drive hit hard. Kelly on the run. That ball is over the boards. Home run. Gary DeSarcina leads off the eighth. So three solo home runs for Anaheim. And it's a one-run game, and the Mariner bullpen starts to get loose.
Well, DeSarcina just gets out in front of the ball right here. Once again, this is a slider that doesn't get in. Look where Danny Wilson's set up. You see him have to reach back out over the middle of the plate if he would have caught that ball.
Oh, the leadoff man is on, over, and in.
That's amazing how when you have to reach back out over the middle of the plate when you're a catcher, a lot of times you don't ever catch the pitch that's thrown.
Tony Phillips pops it back, foul out of play, and with DeSarcina. All you have to do is put a good swing on the ball because Johnson's going to provide the power, right?
Unfortunately, a lot of times you feel like you have to muscle up. You get a bigger swing, it slows you down, and all the combination of all those things hurt you. If you relax, take your time, and actually slow things down, you have a better chance of hitting the guy who throws hard.
95 miles an hour.
And you can bet, as you look at the line of Randy Johnson, 126 pitches, Tony Phillips better be hacking up there anything close.
He almost got run out his last time up. The 1-2. Foul back. It'll stay a ball, two strikes. The former Blue Jays, Spoljarek and Timlin.
Those guys do everything together. Play for the Jays together. Warm up over here together for the Mariners.
Johnson peers over the top of that glove. Phillips beats it into the turf. A-Rod charges. Quick throw. Got him. One out. Well, DeSarcina's hit a home run tonight. Jim Edmonds, the man Johnson hasn't been able to solve. He's 3-for-3 and this is last at bat.
Bailing and wailing. Got the job done. Edmonds feeling so happy, even picked up Danny Wilson's face mask and gave it back to him. That usually doesn't get you a better pitch to hit.
So what's Wilson saying to Randy right now?
Don't let him hit another home run off of you. I think Randy Johnson is either going to go harder away or come in on him. I think he feels like both pitches that got hit out of the park were left out over the plate, so he's got to go one or the other. And I think he's upset enough with his performance, especially against Edmonds, that he's going to come in on Edmonds, get him back off the plate.
He misses low. One ball, no strikes. Danger, danger. Jim Edmonds in the box, and he does not look comfortable. He's the most comfortable 3-for-3 he's ever been in his life. Slider miss low. 2-0. Tim Salmon waiting on deck. Natives restless here in Seattle.
Pretty impressive hit zone right there for Jimmy Edmonds.
Right through there, 96 miles an hour.
Edmonds had no intention of swinging at any of the first three pitches that he's seen in this at-bat. Taking all the way.
He fought off the breaking ball. Now it's 2-2. This is where I've always said, if Randy Johnson ever had a changeup that he felt comfortable enough to use, it would almost be unfair.
Well, he's not going to leave a lackadaisical pitch in this situation.
Full count now. He goes from 96 with the fastball to 86 with the slider. Now the 3-2 pitch. Edmonds gears up. Here she comes. Ball four. Tying run aboard in the eighth. And slugger supreme, Tim Salmon set to dig in. That's the first Randy Johnson free pass of the night. Now Lou Piniella makes the long, slow
You think he's going to pull him right here, Chip? I think he's just out to talk to him. See how he feels. 134 pitches is quite a bit. If, in fact, they don't use him again for the rest of the season until the playoffs, they'll have enough rest. A little friendly conversation between Pinella and Larry Boa, third base coach of the Angels. I don't know what he said to him.
He said, I'm just going to leave Randy in there for a couple more hitters just to dominate right here. We'll get you out real quick.
Even Boa has to laugh. Well, Randy would love the 6-4-3 double play. Well, he hit it to that spot, but through the hole left side. So, first, and now he tries for third. He is out! Edmonds never stopped running. And Kelly threw an eight-hopper to third, and Randy Johnson tips the cap to his left fielder.
Well, that move surprised everybody in the house. I think Larry Boa stopped smiling very quickly here. Edmonds, this is just a bad decision right here, especially at this point in the ball game. Not too many guys can go from first to third on a sharply hit ball to left field on the turf. But watch the way Kelly reacts. Comes up and he says, oh, now I got to pump it in there. He throws a two-hopper right to the bag and everybody's out.
Dave Hollins cuts through a fastball. Boy, what a huge momentum turn that play is going to be.
That kept Randy Johnson in the game.
He was out with ease. Strike two.
That gave Randy Johnson an opportunity to finish this ball game if they want to let him.
One ball, two strikes. He's nearing 140 pitches in the game, and he's still in the mid-90s. Old foul down the left field line. Good play again by the ball girl.
Picking and grinning down there. I don't know, Chip. I can't imagine him coming back out for the ninth. I know the fans would want it. You got to think of your future here. 140 pitches is quite a bit. He's capable of doing that, but talking about getting three more outs in the ninth inning. And he's not out of this one yet.
One ball, two strikes. In case you wondered, Randy Johnson, when he's thrown 154 or more pitches in his career,
or more,
is 3-1. Yeah, he's got one 161 pitch game, 160 pitch, 159, 157, and a 154 in his career. Throwback, folks. He likes to finish what he starts. This copyrighted telecast is presented by the authority of the Commissioner of Baseball and may not be reproduced or retransmitted in any form without expressed written consent. Dancing in the aisles at the Kingdome in Seattle, Randy Johnson, the reaction.
Now 142 pitches, 94 of them strikes.
And it's ironic, 94 the strike number, because that's about the slowest fastball he's thrown in the game tonight. Seattle would love an insurance run. They lead now 4-3. Martinez, Rodriguez, and Buehner to bat in the eighth. Mike James, pierced tongue and all.
he's a throwback too. To Manhattan Beach and the Surfer Dudes.
He brings the three quarters to sidearm and he misses outside Edgar. 1-0. Martinez 0 for 3 tonight.
Edgar Martinez just lost the release point right there from James. Throws kind of sidearm there with the peace sign hanging from his chain.
Oh, good fastball there. And it's 2-1.
Got the sideburns working, the peace sign, the pierced tongue. Might even have some other piercings we don't know about.
You probably don't want to find out about.
5-5 record with an ERA of over 4.5. You get all that other stuff working for you, you better be a good pitcher.
The Mariner cause. So James walks the first man he faces here in the eighth, and that's a critical insurance run in the game. And Edgar Martinez draws the walk, and he will be pulled from the game. Lee Tinsley is going to come on and become the pinch runner for the Mariners here in the eighth inning. The executive producers for Major League Baseball on FX are Arthur Smith and Bill Borson. The coordinating producer is Kevin Landy. Tonight's game was produced by Jim Zrake and directed by Gary Don Garcia. And the head of field operations is Andrea Jenkins. Alex Rodriguez stands in. He is 2-4-3. He's single, he's tripled, he tries to punt. He fouls it away. We want to thank everyone who has helped us bring our first year of Major League Baseball to you on FX and Fox Sports Net. And these are the folks who have contributed so much to our broadcast this year. Our thanks to all of them for what has been a great first season of baseball, and we look forward to many, many more, and still some more fun left, not only in tonight's game, but this week as well. Leah short lead at first. Alex takes high and away. The count evens at 1-1.
This is a tough bunting situation for Rodriguez. You know Alisea is going to be charging. He should be bunting this ball to the right side. But James is a good athlete, and so is Dave Hollins at first. Getting a big, even though he has to hold Tinsley on, he gets the big jump off of the bag and going to put down a pretty good bunt in order to get the job done.
Tinsley back.
Rodriguez handles the bat well enough where they probably give him the option of the old butcher boy play, which is bunt the ball if you're supposed to, but if you feel a little bit of pressure from the infielders, you can pull the bunt back and slap hit the ball somewhere. Get a ground ball in the infield.
And the first, Tinsley back. He's had a star-crossed season this year. Activated for the 15-day DL September 3rd, has batted just twice since. Has had all kinds of problems with a sore right elbow. In fact, has had arthroscopic surgery once this year to take bone chips out of the elbow. That is Lee Tinsley. And that is Alex Rodriguez.
That's an ugly helmet he's got on.
Again, he bunts, and again, he bunts foul. The AL West race could be decided tonight. The NL West race getting a little tighter. The Giants fall to the Rockies, 7-6. Colorado now 4.5 games out of first. The Dodgers beat San Diego at home, 6-2. LA now a game and a half out. Los Angeles will head to Colorado for the final 4 days of the season. The Giants will try to hang on to that 1.5 game lead. Tinsley, the lead from first, the 1-2 pitch. Little bouncing ball towards second.
Phillips to DeSarcino on to first double play. The failure to get the bunt down costs the Mariners two outs. 4-6-3 double play, and boy, did DeSarcino turn a beauty.
Now this is just a room service ground ball to Phillips. Gets the ball to DeSarcino, and then the nice throw with the jump at the same time. Rodriguez with the twisted ankle from the at-bat before doesn't get down the line quite as quickly as he normally would. Makes your ankle hurt even worse when you ground into a double play after you were supposed to get a bunt down.
So A-Rod can't get the job done. James gets the room service double play ball. Now bases empty, two outs for Jay Buhner, who's hit a long home run already tonight. And a quick strike. The Mariner bullpen is busy. Heathcliff Slocum warming up. We shall see if Randy Johnson comes out to start the top of the ninth.
Now Mike James is featuring his best pitch. It's the fastball. Buhner loves to hit a fastball.
Breaking ball, and he swung through it.
There's a pitch that Buhner wants back right now. He's going to see that one in his sleep tonight. That was a big old backup hanging slider with a sign all over it that said, crush me, and Buhner missed it.
The 0-2 pitch now, all to Jay Buhner. Got him with a fastball on the outside corner. And the side is retired. We're through eight. The Mariners need three outs for the Western Division Championship. Our final MCI Interactive fan question comes from Jim Nolan, watching tonight in Denver, Colorado. Does Randy Johnson, Steve, have a shot at the Cy Young?
Answer him.
I don't think so, Jim. Randy's missed a couple of starts. And quite frankly, the season Roger Clemens is having for Toronto.
Yeah, I think what it comes down to is I don't think he'll win it. Does he have
both?
A shot at it? Yes.
He has a shot, yeah.
First in strikeouts, third in wins, second in ERA, first in average against. Certainly had a tremendous year. Unfortunately, that guy north of the border that plays for the Jays has had an even better year, and he should win it.
And another guy, Brad Radke, ought to get consideration, too. Heathcliff Slocum, though, takes over in the ninth. It has been a white-knuckle ride for the Mariner bullpen all season long. Why, however, are the Mariners in first place with their good play lately? Their bullpen has been tremendous. They've given up one run in their last 16 innings. They have, however, converted just 37 of 62 save opportunities. Slocum, 9 of 10 since coming from the Red Sox. Line drive, base hit center field. Tying run is on in the ninth. Base hit by Palmeiro.
There's a guy who definitely has some white knuckles. They're on the phone. Nardi Contreras getting somebody else up.
And you know, the guys in the pen, as well as they have pitched lately.
Looks like Spolgerek getting up.
That is in everybody's head is, here we go again. Last time out, Slocum walked two, but got the save. First pitch swinging, Anderson flies to shallow left. Kelly under, one down in the ninth.
And it doesn't help the psyche of the guy who's on the mound. It doesn't help anybody that's in the bullpen potentially pitching. When you bring in a guy in the ninth inning with a run lead to close out the game, and the first guy that gets a base hit, you have two more guys up and throwing in the pen.
Wilson out to talk things over with Slocum. Alisea, the batter for Anaheim. Mariners two outs away from their second Western Division crown.
Important thing to remember here for Heathcliff Slocum is to try to get Alisea to hit a ball on the ground. Unless he hits a one or two hopper right out at one of the middle infielders with Alisea's speed, it'd be tough to double him up. It's important for the infielders to remember in this situation to make sure of one out somewhere.
Alisea's had a fine night. Steve, right call. How big was that play by Edmonds at third base in the eighth? With one out, after drawing a walk, Tim Salmon
rips a shot through the hole left side. Edmonds trying to advance from first to third. A great hustle play. But Kelly threw him out by a stride. And that turned the tide for Johnson in the inning.
There's Lou Piniella. How worried is he? He shaved this morning.
Down and in. A ball and a strike. Slocum trying to save it for Lou Piniella and for Randy Johnson. Mariners with a win wrap up the West. Fastball high. It's 2-1. The extra men for Anaheim. Encarnacion, Turner, Graybeck, Einhorn, Howell, and Erstad. Piniella has Spoljarek up just to keep Erstad sitting on the pine. Two balls and a strike. Alisea ready, the pitch, change of beauty.
This pitch is up in the strike zone by design. Try to get the chase up in the zone. It's a pitch that you think you can hit, especially from the left side. Very difficult to get on top of, but very hard to lay off of. Luis Alisea couldn't hold up the swing, and now he's just holding up part of the bench.
So Lou Piniella's Mariners are one out away from polishing off the AL West. Chad Kruder, the scheduled hitter. The man on your right is Jack Howell. He will be announced as the Anaheim pinch hitter.
Sure what the conversation on the mound has been all about. Slocum's faced all these hitters before. Wilson may just want to make sure that they have the same thinking patterns as far as how to go after Jack Howell.
He swings and he misses the first pitch. You're two strikes away, Seattle.
When he puts Slocum is down in the strike zone, he can be as tough as anybody. When he gets into troubles, when his ball comes up, it straightens out and it doesn't sink like that pitch.
This season of such huge expectations, now down perhaps to its final strike. And now Hal calls for time. Pitch out, nothing doing. has left.
Not a good time to leave.
One ball, two strikes. Tying run aboard for Anaheim in the ninth. It gets by Wilson. And on to second goes Palmeiro. A base hit now could tie the game.
Well, Danny Wilson, one of the best catchers in the game at blocking balls, but one of the most difficult balls to block is a fastball. You don't expect it to be in the dirt. That ball skips right off a home plate. Wilson pretty much does everything he can to stay in front of it and just scoots underneath his shin guards there. Ball skipped on him a little bit because it hit the plate.
So the Angels get 90 feet on the house. A base hit by Howell here.
I'll tell you, I just
could tie the game.
I don't understand the mound meetings going on right now. This is the third time that Wilson's been out to talk to Heathcliff Slocum. You think he's a rookie that just got called up last week. There isn't nothing to say right here. Throw a strike, let's win the thing.
In the mid. And now the count's 3-2.
This ball hits him off the thumb pad. It's like there's a trampoline in his glove. Then it hits McKeon. He's going to kick it around for a while. No one knows where it is. They're playing a little soccer out there. Can't use your hands, you know.
Well, it's never easy when you get to that Mariner pen. Two strikes. Slocum ready. So's Howell. He stays alive.
I'll tell you what, Howell has had a great year off the bench for the Angels, and he does have home run power.
Again, the 3-2 pitch. He got it, and the Mariners are champions of the AL West.
This whole ball club with a huge sigh of relief, and the bullpen got it done.
Randy Johnson wins his 19th game of the year. He strikes out 11 men. Jay Buhner hits his 40th home run of the season. And Seattle's bullpen, it's a
Achilles heel for most of the season, continues its run of very good work here in the final 2.5-3 weeks of the regular season. Sights on either the Orioles or the Yankees in their first round playoff matchup. The series will start here at the Kingdome.
All the players now trading their Mariner caps in for American League Western Division champs. Field taking pictures.
Well, that holds to form. That's exactly what he did during the All-Star game. Here's the last pitch of the game. Heathcliff Slocum on the mound for the Mariners, trying to save his 10th game in 11 tries, and he got Hal swinging with a nasty split. And the celebration begins here at the Kingdome.
That bench seemed mighty relaxed there until the last out was made.
And as we said at the top of the show, it's deja vu all over again. The Anaheim Angels, the opposition, when Seattle won their first division title back in 1995. Tonight, Randy Johnson wasn't as overpowering as he was a couple of years ago, but just as effective, as Seattle wins the game by a final score of 4-3 here at the Kingdome before a crowd of over 52,000 here on FX.
I think one of the amazing things about that celebration, Chip, is that it started on the mound as it usually does, and that whole crowd migrated out towards center field where the true leader of this ball club stands. They all headed towards Ken Griffey Jr.
So they start to pop open the champagne in the Seattle locker room. Mariners have won the division title. And again, talking to those guys before the game, the big question.